This county, bless our high fighters, service people, everyone that works in the county. Please take care of all the elected officials to make the right choice. Thank you. In your honor, amen. Pledge allegiance.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Item 3, the adoption of the agenda. Are there any changes to the agenda?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. Yes, sir. After discussing it with council, I'd like to remove item number 22.
To another date or just remove it?
I think just remove it.
Mr. Tam, I don't think that's not a C item. That's not what you're talking about.
Okay.
That's another item altogether. That item you're talking about, I don't think it's on the agenda at all. Talking about community improvement.
Right. So what's this enabling legislation?
Well, I'll go over it. It has nothing to do with that.
Okay.
Never mind.
It has nothing to do, I think, with what you're talking about.
Excuse us. Anybody else?
Yes, I'd like to request that we postpone item 28. I'm not sure where the money's coming from this. Some monies that I thought were available don't appear to be, and until I sort of get my arms around that, I'm certainly not inclined to talk about sidewalks today.
Just put it to one, sir.
Next work session.
Second.
Discussion?
Yes, I'd like not to postpone that item. I think that the money is there. It's in transportation. It's SPLOST transportation. In fact, part of this is a SPLOST project voted on or approved by the voters. John Kennard has met with or talked with David Gruen, and money is there.
Can I ask you a question?
Sure.
Why would Mr. Both not be aware of that?
Didn't know that until about 30 seconds ago.
What did you mean?
And do we have any information here today?
Doug, you know anything?
John, are you here to discuss that, prepared?
Well, I can. I provided Brian a cost estimate, and David Gruen also sent an email, said funds were
made. I'll remove my second, so we'll have an opportunity to discuss it.
We can keep discussing
it
second. Keep
going,
you want to keep
it on
the agenda?
I think so, because he's going to make presentations, so I think it'll be on the discussion for us.
Move your second for taking off the agenda. Motion dies for lack of second. Any other changes? Council?
No, sir. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Is there a motion to adopt the agenda?
Second.
We have a motion, have a second. Everyone please vote. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 5-0. On to item 4. Number one, rescission of the contract between Forsyth County and Advanced Ambulance Service.
Something I'd like to read if I may.
Well, it's the county attorney.
Mr. Chairman, that is what, it's just a rescission on the agenda, which means the simple majority can be taken to rescind something for which there's been prior notice. This would retain to the agreement for ambulance services that was approved on December 6th, but of which you don't have a written agreement yet. And so, Commissioner Levant, I believe it's the floor is yours.
Because of the discussion we had in the past, I'm going to make a motion with the intent that I believe we're going to re-accept a different agreement. On December 6th, 2012, the Board of Commissioners authorized an amendment of an agreement between Forsyth County Advanced Ambulance that included, among other things, a 10% rate increase for 2013. That would then be followed by a 3% rate increase for the duration of the agreement. However, based upon subsequent discussions with Advanced Ambulance, it has been learned that Advanced Ambulance is prepared to accept less than a 10% increase for 2013. Those new terms will be discussed in the next agenda item, consequently, because no written agreement has been signed affecting that 10% amendment, it is appropriate to rescind it. Therefore, I move that the board rescind the December 6th, 2012 vote approving the contract amendment between Forsyth County and Advanced Ambulance.
Second. We have a motion and a second. Any other discussion?
Just real quick, was that meant to be time sensitive, given that we're about to consider another?
Absolutely, I'm sorry. My motion is.
And ask the maker of the second if there
are. Second. Okay. All in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 5-0 to rescind the contract. Approval. Item 2, consideration of amendment to the ambulance contract between Forsyth County and Advanced Ambulance. County Attorney.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, this is sort of the other shoe to drop with respect to the first agenda item. We had been working on memorializing what the board had agreed to in December and didn't have that done yet. And in light of the additional negotiations, it made no sense to bring an agreement that would eventually or immediately be amended. So this all makes sense from a timing standpoint. What I have in front of me and what you have not had the benefit of yet, and I'll explain why, is an amendment that would take the place of what Commissioner Levant just rescinded, what the board just rescinded. The amendment would, for all practical purposes, be the same deal, except for two critical issues, and I want to roll through them very quickly with you. Number one pertains to what was mentioned in Commissioner Levant's motion for rescission, which is the amount of the enhanced fee for 2013. I believe that in the amendment that was done in December, it was 3% plus 7% in 2013 for a total of 10%. And then, of course, every year thereafter, it would be 3%, but it would already be on top of the 10%. Everybody understands? So it would almost have a little bit of a compounding effect, and I think that was causing some folks some heartburn. What this new amendment would do would change the 2013 increase to 8%, which would be 3% plus 5% for 1 year. Then at the end of 2013, rather than have the next year's 3% go on top of that 8%, it would in fact only be 3% over a 2013 figure as if it had been 3%. Everybody following me? So in other words, the 5% increase only has a 1 year lifespan and then is gone. So we have modified the agreement to include that. I believe the representatives of Advanced are comfortable with that. But I do want to bring you to an issue that I'm still grappling with, which is why I don't have something literally that you could sign today, and I want y'all to hear this as well. I don't think it'll be anything too terribly difficult to understand or news to anybody, but here's what I'm dealing with. One of the issues that we agreed to in December was a buyback, meaning that during the course of the agreement, if at any time the county went with our own ambulance fleet or decided to part ways with Advanced, we would agree to buy back that equipment that was dedicated to handling the county's ambulance service from Advanced. Okay, that's fairly clear, and I think I understand that. So Advanced, in good faith, has provided us a list of the equipment for which we would be required to buy back. That's easy. The problem is that for a multi-year agreement,
I have to be able to tell you for each year of its renewal what your financial obligation would be for that year. Which means that in year three, if we decide to terminate and go our own way with an ambulance contract or perform our own ambulance services in-house, the law says you need to know the exact amount of your obligation financially, which would include that buyback, right? So I have to therefore be able to do, one, an assessment of the value of all that equipment that's dedicated to our ambulance service, right? And then I have to depreciate it over the life of this contract so that literally with the turn of the page, you could look and say, okay, in year three, if we decide to terminate, we have to pay this much in fees and buy back this exact amount. Everybody with me? All right. I have numbers, but I've been speaking with David and Gruen from finance. Our concern is we don't have, and please don't take this the wrong way, but we don't have a way of confirming the present value of the equipment right now without someone being able to go out there and provide us a third-party figure on what that equipment is worth. Everybody with me? That's the only concern I'm having. I just want to make sure our baseline is accurate. These gentlemen have been good enough to provide us the list of equipment and their estimates, but I think in all candor, we probably ought to make sure that their estimates and maybe a third-party estimate are the same.
Is that necessary absolutely now, or if that comes to fruition?
It needs to be now, because I've got to have something in writing that you can know now that if you terminate in year three, here's exactly what we have to pay these gentlemen.
So you're looking for a number today with a fair depreciation amount each year percentage?
Correct. And the only issue I have, Mr. Gruen has run all the numbers, it's just making sure I have that figure today is accurate.
Startup number.
So all I would ask of you then, I'm happy with this agreement. I think, you know, let's go forward. But please allow me to have somebody come in and run these numbers and make sure those numbers square.
I think Mr. Rutledge wanted to say something
about it. It's going to change because we're remounting and bringing new trucks. So each year you're going to have a newer truck on board. So I don't know how you want to work that.
Well, see, we talked. That's going to be challenging because to the extent the fleet keeps changing in and out and new equipment, I don't know that I can't capture that unless we open it up and have a new agreement modified every year.
Or do you just do, in this agreement, can you just do an appraisal every year?
It would
maybe
you make it his expense if he wants to turn it into the
dog. It's just going to be the...
Can we not just rescind this since it's so complicated?
It's rescinded. We are starting on a fresh page.
So we don't have to do this anymore.
Well, no, but I'm not trying to get in the way of the deal. I understand your point. I'm just trying to say we can do the deal. That was the one element I didn't have was the present value.
Do you have any idea what a third party costs or charges to do an assessment of a company your size?
No, I don't. I mean, but I could contact some people. I'll pay for
the to have that clause in there, obviously the county will probably want to pick that third party, so we feel it's a fair third party. The question is, would you be willing to pay that in the agreement? Since Ms. Mills has a concern with, obviously, who's going to pay that every year.
I have a concern with any open-ended.
I
just don't feel
Look,
I'm trying to find a solution.
The value for the entire fleet, and it's more than ambulances, it's ambulances and it's equipment and it's things, is $550,000. That's the value they provided to it. I don't think anything is jumping out at me that says that's not the correct value, but I think, you know, before finance signs off of it, I understand that. I mean, you're saying, look, I'm not an ambulance expert. I don't know what that value is. That looks as good as any other number. It doesn't seem high by any stretch, but I just thought I have an abundance of caution ought to bring you this concern. If you all want to go forward with this, I have a depreciation schedule that is ready to be part of an exhibit to this agreement right now.
Mr. Gruen, have you ever dealt with these before? Is there a set percentage of companies charged based on the amount that they find the company's value is, that they get a percentage of that as their fee?
Do an appraisal?
Well, it's not appraisal of the company. It's only the vehicles
and
equipment.
To appraise the equipment.
That's correct.
It's not the company.
It's not the company.
No, I probably defer to Don. I'm used to seeing more often a fixed fee. I don't know that they take a percentage of what they appraise.
That would tend to influence
the appraisal. Window that might
land in. I really don't off the top of
my head. And Mr. Rutledge, are you willing to take on that?
As long as it's a reasonable cost, I'm willing to take it.
Well, we don't know what that is, though. This is,
I mean, I don't think it's going to be that much commission.
So up to $2?
Well, we got to $550. It couldn't
That's what he submitted right now.
He submitted $550,000, and Mr. Gruen's running an appreciation schedule that gets us home.
So that's up to number right now. I mean, he's agreed.
We will have to hire somebody, to do our own appraisal to see.
Are there any way that there's any book value we can look at, or being parameters to buy this resales or
I don't know. Would anybody, would anybody at Fleet be able to do this with any sort of
See, the other problem is that it sounds like it's probably going to change every year. It's not like this is the equipment that you depreciated. It's this it's equipment, and then it'll change next year.
Well, then that means we have to rewrite the contract.
No, see, I can answer that. I mean, we're entering into a five-year agreement right now, and this is the baseline. And to the extent that that ambulances change, unless you modify the agreement, this is all we would be responsible for buying back.
Just what was
here.
That's what I'm saying. But if you want us to add a new ambulance next year, we'd have to change the.
We would have to change the agreement to fold that ambulance into.
That's what I'm saying.
How bad is that?
I mean, it's just more paperwork for us. We can
reassess and reevaluate every year, you're going to do now. Fold all that back in.
I hate it, but
can I make a suggestion? If we do it at this amount and not be able to see this amount, it would only leave Mr. Rutledge short if he does add new ones in. And leave it up to him as the option if he wants to sell it to the county for that low number.
But that may be a high number. We're looking at a basis that, in reality, it may be only worth $450. I'm not saying Stan's wrong, but that's, how cars and things depreciate. So we're looking at $550, and his value is an up figure. But it could be, in reality, $400, $450 if we take an appraisal of everything. If we buy him out, we're going to pay him $550.
How much is a new ambulance? Loaded out, already ready to go, hit the street.
With equipment on?
Yeah, equipment on, ready to go.
About $175.
About $175. And how many of them do you have?
But now
and
that's
then
all
how many
new
years equipment. Did you depreciate that over?
Five. The truck itself is 5 years.
And of course, I don't have to tell you that you line up six appraisers and ask them to give you your opinion. You get six opinions.
I sure wish we'd known this was going to be a. Besides today, so we could have a few days left.
It's fair. It's fair enough.
Work out their own numbers.
I didn't realize it was an issue today till today, but it's a fair. The board would be fully within its rights to go ahead if you all want to approve this new construct. Let me work with Mr. Gruen and Mr. Rutledge, because it wouldn't be ready until a consent agenda in 2 weeks anyway. I could go ahead and do that. I wanted to let you know what the issues I'm grappling with are.
At that time, we'll get Fleet involved and let them see if they can help and Dave Gruen.
I don't know that I'm going to be able to bring you back a number with as much certainty as my staff and we can we can all work with. Okay?
But if we don't have a degree of confidence in it, or if we still have doubt, not in a confidence in your work, but in the agreement, we can just vote not to add it in?
Well,
since it's not a part of the contract, or are we voting that it'll be a part of the contract now?
If we get to the point where it's time to ratify for good this agreement, and I don't feel like in conjunction with my finance director or my fire director of fire department, that we don't have a number that we're comfortable with, I'll take it off. I'll ask you to take it off consent. We'll talk about it on new business.
So do we need to vote on this, or just you go and work on it and bring it back?
I would rather. Well, why don't we go ahead and vote on this with it heading to consent, but I'll take it off consent if I don't have a comfort level that I've got you a document we can live with.
I mean, right now, I don't know that I can be comfortable with doing it at all.
Can I make a recommendation? Forget about consent. If you want to vote on it today, and we'll ask the clerk to put it on the old business agenda. That way it will be discussed again.
Would you like to make a motion, Ms. Dills?
I'll make a motion that we will, for consideration of the amendment to the ambulance contract, advance the ambulance as
presented
by our county attorney.
And this would be put on February 7th.
New old business agenda.
Old business
agenda. Let's make Ms. Mills, if you're agreeable, can we make that part of the motion? It will go on the old business agenda.
Yes, and make it. It will go on the old business. February 7th.
Thank you.
I'll second that motion.
We have a motion and a second. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
No.
Motion carries 5-0. Item 3, adopting the resolution amending the fiscal year 2013 budget for the adjustment of ambulance services. Director of Finance?
Yes, this is the additional funding we need to make available for this account to carry through the entire 2013 year, and which adds $47,834 to that account line for this contract, which is approved on by the board for the next meeting. This comes out of general fund conditions.
This is not time sensitive.
No, at this point not. Covering the entire year. We have funding in that line all for this amount, so it's not time sensitive.
One thing I'd like you to consider is, Dave, and the board, is this a one-time payment, or is this through a 12-month period?
This is only for this year's budget, right? The budget process for 2014.
Check we write in January, or will they receive those funds through a 12-month period?
12-month period.
Oh, it is. I've got those. Gotcha.
Is that?
I thought it was one time.
He said he didn't hear it.
Spread over 12-month period.
That's supposed to be one time.
Yeah, he said agreeable.
All right, okay, we're good.
Do we have a motion then?
One time this year.
I'll make a motion to amend the fiscal year 2013 budget as stated by the finance director. And it'll be $47,000 to be dispersed during a 12-month period.
$47,834.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
No, I said aye, but I did have a question I wanted to ask Donna, if I may. What does that reflect in the contract, that what savings to the county, the dollar amount?
Over the original proposed 3% and 7% cumulative, yes. It'd be about $307,706.
Gotcha.
Yeah, okay.
Item 4, the appointment of clerk to the Civil Service Board for calendar year 2013.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, this is a request for the Civil Service Board for the appointment of the clerk for calendar year 2013. This was postponed from the January 8, 2013 work session. And in your agenda booklet is a request from the Civil Service Board that they request that you reappoint Charity Clark as the clerk to the Civil Service Board for 2013.
Is that you?
Just like me.
You have a motion.
I would make a motion to be appoint the clerk to the Civil Service Board in calendar year 2013 to be Charity Clark.
Second. We have a motion and a second to reappoint Ms. Charity Clark. Everybody in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 5-0.
Thank you.
Thank you, Charity. Thank you for taking the job. Item 5, the approval of addendum 2013 for the agreement for services between Health Designs and South County.
Yes, Chairman and Commissioners. This is an addendum to a previous approved agreement. And Health Designs basically is providing services for biometric screening so employees can participate and get a wellness discount on their health benefits contribution rate. This would allow for employees to have that biometric screening, also have that option to have it performed by their own physician and submit a form to Health Designs for processing and included in the aggregate report. Health Designs would provide the forms and process by which it would go directly to them, and they would process that and just provide us an aggregate report.
And the cost per participant is $29. That's what they have to pay.
We would be paying them. This is actually cost savings to the county. Mm-hmm. A full biometric screening performed by the Health Designs is what, around $54 or $59?
Yeah, around
Yeah, so this is around half that rate. If some, if an employee were to go get it done,
then we're only paying $29.
Yes, to focus on. So it's already been budgeted.
Any questions? Is there a motion?
I make a motion that we approve an addendum 2013 agreement for services between Health Designs Inc. for Forsyth County, defining the cost and process by which employees may choose to provide biometric screening from another source to qualify for the wellness discounted rate for health care coverage in an amount not to exceed $29 per event, per person, per year.
Time sensitive. We have a motion and a second. Time sensitive. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Carried.
Thank you.
Thank you, Matthew. Item six, the acceptance of the 2013 LMIG award from the state of Georgia Department of Transportation in an amount of $1,420,397.19 with required match of $426,419.16.
Yes, good afternoon, Chairman, members of the board. Item six is a request for acceptance for the 2013 LMIG grant award from the state of Georgia Department of Transportation, amount of $1,420,397.19, required match of $426,119.16. This grant award will go to resurfacing various county roads in the county. Match will be made from SPLOST. Approval to apply for this program was granted at December 20th commission meeting. I believe GDOT is planning on being present at the commission meeting. Is that right, John? Are they still going to be there?
February 7th
to present us with a big check, and hopefully we'll get a little check then or shortly after. Item is not time sensitive.
Just add to that, Georgia Department of Transportation will be here, representatives from GDOT will be here, local delegation that's been invited as well. But also, GDOT had asked that the city consider, City Cumming be at that meeting as well, and the city has agreed that GDOT will present the check to City Cumming at the same meeting.
Check.
And that is February 7th.
Any other questions? Is there a motion from the board?
Make a motion we have set for the acceptance of FY 2013 local maintenance improvement grant, LMIG award from the state of Georgia Department of Transportation for $1,420,397.19, required match of $426,119.16.
We have a motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
Have a motion and a second. I have one question. I guess the grants are John. This is a one-time for repaving from the state of Georgia. Do we have?
It's an annual. It's an annual amount, formula amount. It's based on the list with the board approved. We submit back in December about 30 miles of roads, which will be part of our 2013 resurfacing contract. This year, what they're doing a little differently than they've done in past years is they're sending us a check up front and allowing us to manage the contract and oversee the construction. And later in the year, they'll tell us how we're to certify the project to them to meet the requirements of the grant. This is just acceptance of that money that they've already approved for us, and they'll be here, like I said, on February 7th to present the board with the check. And they're doing it for certain local governments throughout the state, and they offer that opportunity to our county.
But it's a totally different way than we've done it before.
Yes, last year we let the contract, but then the state submitted for our reimbursements monthly. So we had to pay the money out and then get reimbursed for it. So it's the only difference this year is that they're giving us all the money up front, allowing us to manage the project and handle all construction, supervision, and inspections. Whereas in 2012, they actually inspected the project for us.
Do you think this will cover all our resurfacing needs this year?
It will not. In fact, the list that we presented to them was more than enough to allow for our required obligation for the 20% match. See, our total obligation based on the LMIG contract is about 1.8 something million dollars. It's the 1.4 that we get from GDOT plus the required match, 30% match, not 20%. But our contract will be much more than that. We'll include additional SPOSH funds for our 2013 resurfacing. And we've yet to complete the list for the number of roads and the miles of roads and the actual roads that we'll do in 2013. All we've done thus far is to submit a list of about 30 miles of roads to meet our obligation under the LMIG grant. But we'll formalize and finalize our total list of roads and contract that out, and that award of contract will come to the board later in the year, probably late spring, early summer.
Just want to make sure the board understands the new LMIG regulations. Okay, have a motion and a second. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Motion carries. 5-0. Item 7, appointment of members to the Social Services Committee.
Chairman, members of the board. The board will recall a recent meeting that many of the committees that the board has and made decisions on were had different commissioners appointed them. One committee that was not included in that date, and normally would not be, because these terms are for 2 years, running from 2012 through this year, is the Social Services Committee. However, since one of the two commissioners serving on that committee is no longer on the board this year, we do ask that the board name a second commissioner to the committee. The other commissioner is Jim Boff, who is will be finishing his 2-year term this year.
We have, that's a 5-member board, correct?
Yes, it is.
And we have some questions about Nicole Morgan, who's looking at replacing her at this time.
Right, she's indicated she will be leaving the area and taking some other employment. We don't yet have a name to recommend to replace her. There's not need to do so right now, since this committee's work will not begin until a little bit later on in the year. So we plan to bring back to the board another name to replace Nicole.
And I would assume also she's the head of a group called Community Connections. Assuming that they continue and there is a new person who takes her place, that's at least a logical person.
Right. And maybe that person doesn't have a name yet.
The one problem we have, though, is Nicole, or anybody on this board, is a 5-member board, and Nicole made herself a non-voting member. So when it did end in ties, it was 2-2. There was no way to break it. So we need to either make her a vote member, or look at adding another.
Why do you suppose she needs something?
I think she did that on her own.
She did.
The resolution doesn't distinguish between voting and non-voting members. I think that she did that on her own because I think she was a representative of some of the entities that were actually up for funding. So I think what it signals is the next time we put somebody on there, don't let that be from a group that is subject to being funded by that committee.
That's what I was getting.
Or either make them vote or have somebody else on it, make it a board where somebody else votes to break the ties.
Can we add another member?
You can add
another member, maybe.
Then you get the thing where people show up,
We need 5 voting
members. But I agree.
I don't disagree, but I can tell you from having been there that having the person from Community Connection there at the meetings tremendously helpful. Now maybe they don't have to be on the board, but
we can add him as a 6 member, but a non-voting.
That's non-voting member, maybe.
Ex officio.
Sure. No, we can look at that. Right now we need to replace Patrick Bell, the ex-commissioner, correct?
Yes, sir.
Do we have any commissioners?
Mr. Austin staying on?
Well, it's
we haven't got
my terms on.
Not up yet. Mr. Bell, does he have any involvement on the board want to be on that?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I nominate Cindy Mills to be on the Social Services Board.
Second.
Just need to be time sensitive since he's already gone.
I don't think so. I don't think they have any business. Sorry. Okay.
We have a motion to second to place Cindy Mills on the vacated position of Patrick Bell. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. 5-0.
Mr. Chairman, is there any directive to the to staff to bring anything back to board with respect to a 6 member or an amendment to the resolution to allow for new changes?
Well, I agree with Mr. Boff. If the Community Connection person wants to be on there, they can be the 6 member, but a non-voting member. But we do need a voting member as the is one part of five.
Without any conflicts.
Without a conflict of interest of serving on the board that's receiving money.
Fine, okay.
Is that all right?
Yep. Make sure I was clear on that.
Item eight, memorandum of understanding between Forsyth County and Keep Forsyth County KFC Beautiful.
Chairman and Commissioners, Keep Forsyth County Beautiful was established by the county in 1993. Over the years, it's taken on several looks, and the latest look under the previous county manager who served on that board, she established Keep Forsyth County Beautiful as a department, and it had never been operated as a department before. And I've been working with Doug and Tim and Ken Gerard now for some time, because Keep Forsyth County Beautiful actually being a department has kind of caused some people looking from the outside. If you look from the outside in to what Keep Forsyth County Beautiful does, it raises questions. So we are asking to dissolve in the 2013 budget, dissolve Keep Forsyth County Beautiful as a department. And the program, affiliate program Keep Forsyth County Beautiful, operate out of the solid waste department as a program rather than a department. And what this memorandum of understanding would allow is the program would exist the same way it does today, operating out of solid waste. It would allow the nonprofit board of directors to keep the name Keep Forsyth County Beautiful and continue to work with the county in this basically the same way we're working now, except not have a department with that name. No county funds would be exchanged to the nonprofit board. I would continue to do the work that I do with Keep Forsyth County Beautiful. In kind, things like that would still be the same. Volunteers would still work. Just the department would be dissolved.
You're trying to separate yourself.
And make it a whole lot easier to manage. The board of Keep Forsyth County Beautiful, which is a requirement to be a Keep America Beautiful affiliate, you have to have a board of directors. They've always been bringing funds into the county to support the program. And just recently, over the last couple of years, applied for nonprofit status in order to be able to do that. And what that does is, when people look from the outside and they see that name is tied to the county and the nonprofit, and it just causes a lot of questions. So this would clear that up, and that name would no longer be a county entity other than a program.
How many board directors do you have?
Right now we currently have 20, and that's the limit. First time we've ever had a full board.
So that's a state limit or county limit?
It's a county limit according to the bylaws of Keep Forsyth County Beautiful. Now we do have some members that are rolling off because we do have term limits. So I've got five members that are rolling off, so we'll be down to 15. And it's a partially appointed board in that the commissioners have an opportunity to appoint someone. They don't necessarily have to. But the rest of the board members are simply volunteers who apply to serve on that board. So we have people from all walks, companies, schools, government.
And your board works events?
Yes.
I mean,
yes, it's a working
Christmas
board.
Tree,
they help plan, but they also are a volunteer working board.
Any questions for the board?
Do you like the new name?
Well, the name's not going to change. I have dual roles now. I work for Keep Forsyth County Beautiful, and I also work for Solid Waste Department. So I will still represent Keep Forsyth County Beautiful, the affiliate program. I just will not do any administration of the nonprofit. I won't be in any way tied or liable for the nonprofit.
Board of directors will be.
The board of directors will be. So I will work with them in planning the same way that I've always done. But it relieves the county from that look of that nonprofit, and also me from all responsibility.
But I want to make it clear, you're not voting today on the name Recycling Solid Waste Department.
No.
That's something that that I can do administratively when the time comes and make that change.
Any other questions? The motion?
Make the motion that we approve the memorandum of understanding with Keep Forsyth County and what now is called Keep Forsyth Beautiful, aim to administer the Keep America Beautiful affiliate program.
Second. A motion and a second. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 5-0. Item 9A, this is renewal following agreement. 9A is the agreement with ACOM for operations and maintenance of the fallow wastewater treatment plant.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. I've made a new copy of the last agreement with all the final revisions. Ken, I don't think you provided
that's
that.
Not in the agenda book?
I do not believe it is. Okay. I think this is the final. Okay. This is the last one that came out.
Okay.
Excuse me. I'd like to distribute that. I think I made enough for everybody. And this is our annual renewal with ACOM to run the operations and maintenance of our Fowler wastewater treatment facility. The major difference you'll see is that we have changed the payment schedule for approximately a 36-month period so that over 80% is paid by the fixed fee versus the flow-based fee, and that is so that we meet IRS regulations so that we can also have ACOM move forward with changing out some more membranes. The membranes are at their cost, but their request was that if in case we cancel the contract for convenience during that 36-month period, that we would reimburse us for the cost of the membranes. And in doing so, we can do this because we have an actual pay down period that goes over the 3 months.
If I can just interrupt real quick, you may see, remember what she just said, that if we terminate during the course of the contract, we have to pay them back. Hope that sounds familiar to everybody. And as you'll note, in this agreement, there is a price for the membranes, and then there is a monthly schedule that it comes. So in other words, you could look at this contract today and tell if we terminate in month 24, how much we have to pay out.
Mm-hmm. Just want to make. Was this part of the, I don't know, controversial, but one time there was a little interesting twist in what membranes are going to use, who they're going to come from, and whether or not ACOM already owed these to us.
Correct. These membranes are the cost of ACOM. They owe
they
us
already owe these to us on past contracts.
They owe us in our current contract. It's just an annual contract that's renewed. They owe us the membranes for the maintenance of it. What we did is we changed the membranes from C's to D. So we upgraded the technology of it. So what they're doing is the two existing membranes, what they're going to do, and Tim Perkins and jump in, we're going to take out the best of what's left of the two existing and put them into one location and then replace the other one, the complete whole one, with the newer technology.
I think I know what you're saying. The issue here is when the contract was put out to bid way back when, we had a 2-year cancellation. So they didn't feel at risk that they would have everything upgraded, put in brand new pumps, motors, blowers, the whole works, and then they'll say, great, you got us back to 100%, we're gonna cancel your contract, see ya. And so a few years ago, because of some bond issues, we had to go to an annual contract. So they went from having a 2-year comfort level to a 1-year. So they're hesitant to put $300,000 worth of upgraded equipment or any other equipment in without some assurance that if we just cancel the call because we want to, that they've got some pro rating.
Am I not remembering some of the discussion though back? I think the other company was Kubota.
Mm-hmm.
And it was bouncing around a lot, and there was some pretty clear discussion, I thought, that the time frame in which they'd already been there under contract, that the first two membrane areas were already getting old, and they should have already replaced those under the old contract and determined which those contracts already existed. So if we're talking about them only changing out one now, picking out and grabbing whatever they think they can preserve for a little bit longer, put them into the second one, why are we guaranteeing to pay them back money when they already probably owe this over past contracts?
I understand you, Commissioner. This is part of working with them as a company. It is a fear that we will just cancel for convenience at any moment after they invest this money into our system. And
they put the two
new ones. There is.
Oh, they have done.
Oh, yes.
They have
done. Okay.
That's complete.
That,
so this is the other. The other two older cells are needing replacement.
Oh, you tell me we're up to four now.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, yeah. Very good.
Yeah. No, the other. So the other work that you approved.
They
back
did the other work
you
approved, and they haven't moved forward with replacing the older membranes.
But they did do the number three and number four,
yes.
Which I thought they were going to do one and two first with three, with new ones and then work three and four in. But
right.
Y'all did it the other way around now.
The two new trains are in.
Gotcha.
Put it back in.
And Commissioner, this is viewed by the county. This is simply maintenance and repair of a sewer plant because membranes give out.
But my only concern was, I know in original discussions were one and two were failing. They should have already replaced those two.
Right.
When you said they're did one and two replace, I didn't realize that was actually three or four now, because those weren't in play at all back then.
I tend to keep them the service number one,
gotcha.
Three, four, I'm sorry. So the two new ones are in place. They are up and running.
The other thing I'm going to be clear on is there was also discussion about if you upgrade, and I don't remember to, the discussion upgrade to what, but that there might be, I'll call them incidental charges in order to get the things to fit properly into the bin or slot or tank or whatever you call it that they go into is I guess we would pay that since we've asked for the upgrade.
No, we're not paying that.
Not paying
that,
that.
Is
why wouldn't we pay
that? Was on the filter system also.
That, well, part of that was on the filter and part of it was
choice.
On the membrane.
That was their
and that was their choice to do this now.
Okay.
They would like to be. They also, these newer membranes have a better efficiency for electricity and power costs, so they pay those costs and their costs will come down.
And then the final thing was the thing about the screen. Still using the old screen, and everybody's okay with that.
It's working, it's operating. Everybody agrees a new screen would improve the performance, but it's meeting the specs, and that's what we paid for.
It's up to them to meet the performance, not us.
Correct.
So it's their obligation. Okay, any other questions?
Let me say one on four again. However, I would hate to think that as we deploy the new technology and offer to buy back if we were to cancel the contract, that we knowingly didn't replace the screens, perhaps at our own expense, and end up in a year or two with the new stuff torn up because we didn't replace the screen. Or having to buy the new technology for whatever the reason, which would not be what I'd expect to happen, but now we bought the new technology that's all gummed up because we didn't replace the screen.
What you're getting into is a little bit of this timing is when's the contract going to expire, and when it expires they have to deliver the plant back to us in a neutral condition.
Okay.
Not brand new, not completely worn out, but you're exactly right. Putting in a new screen now would probably add life to the membranes. It might get them at a different stage when the contract does expire, and so it's really, it's a balancing act. It's hard to tell. They may come back to us at some point in time and want to discuss the screen. They've changed the operations, they've made some improvements, they've made some repairs. It's much better than it was.
I thought they did repairs to the screen.
They did repairs, they've made even more modifications, and they're continuing to look for other ways to improve it.
Are we getting any additional flow out of it?
Yes, we've already brought some of the flow back. We have reduced some of what we were sending to Fulton. And when we get these other membranes replaced, that will increase that even more.
One final thing, I also recall that there was a thing, and I'm completely making up the number because I don't remember, $1,000 a week or something by reducing that flow. Are we coming up on recouping some of that money?
That part of it we have, not all of it. It takes the other.
The
replacement before we
but
can,
we're headed in that direction.
Yes, we've already increased the flow of some of that anticipated revenue savings. We started back in November, and when we get this in, we'll be able to increase that even more.
Great, thank you.
Any other questions?
Mr. Chairman, I just want to point out one thing since it does deal with the financing. The schedule we're working off of anticipates that right now they will make no less than 80% of their monthly income based upon fixed fees, and that's, as Donna correctly said, pursuant to IRS regulations. At the end of the three-year period, we will revert to the fee schedule that was in place before this amendment automatically. I just want you to understand that. We're only doing this three-year 80% rule while we have the mandatory buyback provision. Once the buyback provision's over, it reverts to what it was. That's all.
All right. I guess I'll make a motion to accept the renewal of the agreement with Comcom for operations and maintenance of the power wastewater treatment facility as presented by Ms. Cooperola and county attorney and presented. Oh yeah, not to exceed, I'm sorry. Not to exceed the $1,053,000.
Second. We have a motion and a second. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Time sensitive.
No. Any opposed? Motion carries 5-0.
And just could the clerk reflect that the version that was accepted was what was handed out?
I thought that's what I thought.
It is.
Item 9B, agreements with Bird Brothers, Emergency Services, Sears Environmental, and Crowder Gov for emergency debris removal and disposal services.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm business commission. This is for a pre-event contracts, and we currently have three on-demand contracts, one with Bird Brothers, one with Sears, and one with Crowder Gov. We'd like to renew all of those for calendar year 2013. There is no change in costing. And again, this is one of those ones that we hope that we never have to use. It would just be in the event of a disaster. Thank you.
Environmental diesel, I think I'm that correct. Environmental diesel spill, environmental spills.
Bigger than that, it would actually be a disaster. If we had a tornado or a hurricane or a disaster in the area.
Wow. Any questions from the board? Do I hear a motion?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion to be approved. Or renew the agreement with Bird Brothers Emergency Service LLC, Ceres Environmental, and Crowder Gulf for emergency debris removal and disposal services as outlined in our notes.
We have a motion and second for item 9B. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 5-0. Item 9C, the agreement with Malden and Jenkins for audit services for calendar year 2012.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the board. This is a renewal of our current agreement with Malden and Jenkins Certified Public Accountants, LLC. The work, of course, will be done in 2013, but it's for our audit year of calendar year 2012. It is per our agreement. We would like to award this for the amount of $84,000. I would just like to let you know that while they are doing their audit, there might be the need for additional single audits to be completed, and that will be based upon our federal grants. And we don't know ahead of time. This includes one single audit. So if there are additional, we'll bring that back to your attention. Thank you.
Any questions? Do I have a motion from the board?
Take the motion to accept the renewal agreement with Baldwin Jenkins for audit services for calendar year 2012.
Do I hear a second?
Not to exceed $84,000.
Second. We have a motion and a second for the agreement 9C. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries 5-0. Item 9D, agreement with Mill Creek Environmental Services for as-needed sewer spill sampling and monitoring.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman of the Board. Again, this is a renewal of a previously awarded agreement. This is used by our water and sewer department as an as-needed requirement only. In the case of a sewer spill, the costing is going up from their current agreement from 2012, and the increase is really due to the laboratory costs and travel costs that we have verified. So we would like to renew the agreement with Mill Creek for calendar year 2013. Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions for the board? There your motion.
Mr. Chairman, I make the motion that we accept the agreement with Mill Creek Environmental Services for the spill sampling and monitoring.
Motion and a second for the approval of 9D. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 5-0. Item 9E, the agreement with Moreland Alabama Associates for SPLOSH program management for calendar year 2013.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman of the Board. Again, this is a renewal for calendar year 13. They are program management, the renewal program management agreement. It'd be task order number 4 for this calendar year. We ask that the task order not to exceed $300,000. They've been providing the service. The department is pleased. Just so you know that for this calendar year for 2012 calendar year, we are just at $271,000 of expenditures. Thank you.
Is every year around $300,000?
It is. We usually ask for $300,000. That's what we've allocated.
Yeah.
But like I said, for 2012, it actually came up to just under $271,000.
$29,000 cheaper.
We kept it a very good budget. Good use of time.
Any questions? Do I hear a motion from the board?
Mr. Chairman, I make the motion that we renew the agreement with Oil and Offability Associates for SPLOST program management for calendar year 2015 in an amount not to exceed $300,000 with the authorization of the county manager to sign the task order.
Second. We have a motion and a second to approve 9E. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. 5-0. 9F, the agreement with Pinkerton to provide employment background screening for the personnel services department.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Members, well, this is a renewal for 2013. It is with Pinkerton. They do various background screening for new employees. Their pricing will stay the same as for 2012. And the department has been pleased with their services. Thank you.
Do we actually use a full $4,400 every year for this?
Not always, because we don't always have all those employees.
Yes, sir. Any questions for the board? Is there a motion?
Mr. Chairman, I make the motion that we approve the agreement with Pinkerton to provide employment background screening for the personnel services department in an amount not to exceed $4,400.
Second. We have a motion and a second for the approval of 9L. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Carried 5-0. On item 10, the addendum to the agreement for NALAA Corporation for Animal Shelter Services for calendar year 2014.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the board. As I'm passing out a revised amendment for legal, this is the final that we just got. And it's an update from the one in your book. This is a renewal for animal shelter services for calendar year 2013 in the amount of $480,000, which is the same as it's been for this year. NALA has worked with us and has agreed to extend their services while we're in the pursuit of building our own animal shelter, which hopefully will be completed by the end of this year. Thank you.
Any questions from the board? How long has this contract remained the same?
It has remained the same. Off the top of my head, I think it's the last 4 years.
Yes. Hopefully, once our shelter is completed, we will take over this task.
That's right. And I think that Dr. Orr and Mrs. Orr will be very pleased. They've been very generous in working with us this time.
They're tired. Any questions? Now we hear a motion.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I would move that we accept the addendum to the agreement and with NAL Corporation for the Animal Shelter Services calendar year 2013.
In about $480,000?
$480,000.
We have a motion and a second for the approval of the addendum to the NAL Corporation for the Animal Shelter. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 5-0. Item 11, the renewal membership with Utilities Protection Center for the Call Before the Day program.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman of the Board. This is exactly what that is. It's our renewal of our membership with the Call Before You Dig program, which is Utilities Protection Center. Our cost is based upon the number of tickets that we do in the previous year. So it's when they're doing the budget, they always have to do an estimate. So we are asking to extend the agreement for 2013 with Utilities Protection in the amount of $41,300.63. Thank you.
It's a little bit up on last on the budget amount.
It is, and the water department is transferring funds to cover it.
Okay.
Again, it's always an estimate of the number of tickets that we're going to be having.
And it's also an average statewide if everybody participates, so they divide the cost for that out by the whole region. So if Gwinnett County's numbers are down and ours are up, we're going to pay our percentage based on those tickets. So it's really hard to project.
We have more
and we've been growing.
Yeah, we're growing.
That's why we have saw a big jump year before last.
Because they've gone down the last couple of years before that. So,
but if they miss mark one and somebody hits our water line,
that's just the notification. Yeah. This is the We do our own locates.
We do our own locate.
Yeah, it's worked out a lot better.
It's a one number.
But this is the one call service just to give us the tickets. We get daily several hundred requests a day, and then we have to go through that.
Any other questions from the board? Do I hear a motion?
I'll make a motion to renew the membership of the Utilities Protection Center for Call Before You Dig for calendar year 2013, not to exceed $41,300.63.
Can we do that since we don't really know what the cost is going to be?
No, that is the cost.
That is the cost.
That is. Okay. They base it on the previous year.
Previous year.
Yes.
We have a motion. We have a second. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. 5-0. Item 12, the removal of telephone lines for our property to the jail courthouse. Courthouse jail project.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. Today I'm asking this, if you approve this on a time-sensitive basis. This is to just move the telephone lines that are on the county's property at this site. And it's at a cost of $2,000.95. Thank you.
Time-sensitive.
It is. We'd like it to be time-sensitive. As you can see, they started putting up fencing today. We're moving pavers. And so, and actually, I have to say, AT&T has worked with us. They have moved the lines for us, but we do need to follow up with the agreement. Thank you.
Any questions? We hear a motion.
Make a motion for the approval of removal of telephone lines for property for the courthouse jail project. As you see, $2,000.95 as per day.
Time sensitive. We have a motion and a second for time sensitive item removal of telephone lines. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. 5-0. On item 13, the approval of insurance for our volunteer firefighters.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, of the board. This gets renewed every 3 years. The pricing has remained the same at $8,095 per year. We would like to renew this. This is for our volunteer firefighter for accident and sickness insurance. It's helped to provide unexpected cost, injury, or illness to a firefighter that might suffer during a result of participating in any normal duty or emergency service work. Chief Bowman, if you'd like to add to that. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Cookerell. It also covers accidental death benefits, accidental dismemberment, total disability. Our 35 shift workers, which you could call volunteers, they volunteer to come in and work for a shift. In the past, we had a DeKalb County firefighter lose all of his fingers with a structural collapse. Brent Chesney was killed in 1996. So we've had a number of firefighters that work for other fire departments that also come in and work for us just for a salary and no benefit. Well, if you've lost all your fingers, they're not going to let you go back to your full-time job. And this covers it, and as Ms. Cucarola alluded to, this is a renewal. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
How many volunteers is 35? How many we have total?
35 shift workers, meaning you, Cindy Mills works for the DeKalb County Fire Department full-time. You come in here, and I'll let you work 12 hours or 24. You can't break it up.
It only covers, do we still have volunteers?
Yes, most of them are my age. I'm 63. They pretty much handle the rehab in the front yard, Gatorade, cooling the firemen down, blood pressures. We won't let you go back in unless you drink two bottles of Gatorade and take all your gear off for about 10 minutes. Then I'd let you go back in for about 20 minutes. You generally lose about 8 pounds every fire you fight. Most of that's water.
Do our true volunteers receive hourly pay too?
No, sir.
They just true volunteers.
But we pay for them to have to be in a state pension. To say pension is not a true statement, it's actually an annuity. Once you've paid into it for 20 years, they pay about $700 a month. But we pay for that for the volunteers.
Any other questions? Do we hear a motion?
No motion to approve insurance for volunteer fighters. not to exceed $8,500.
We have a motion and a second to approve the insurance for volunteer firefighters. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 5-0.
Thank you, Tom.
Item 14, request approval of a sewer reservation agreement between Forsyth County and O'Reilly Group.
Mr. Chairman, this is a subdivision that three lots short. It's previous approved, and it's a standard sewer reservation agreement under the old arrangement, and they're just asking approval to purchase three more taps. They forgot about their amenities when they purchased originally, and they also had one more lot.
Is that what the addendum is about?
The addendum, I'm sorry, I don't have my copy because my assistant's not here, but I can find it. They had a pre-purchase arrangement before, and so we're following the same addendum and the same arrangement where they paid an upfront fee in order to buy their final plat. And since they were just their three lots short, they're following the same addendum as before. In other words, if they counted, you know, it's the same deal had they known purchased the correct amount back on the original day.
Well, they're not getting a discount.
No discount, paying the same thing.
Let me ask you one question, Tim. In the future, how do we go about this, allowing you and Doug just to sign off on these miscalculations, say, 1 or 2, 4 or 5?
That's something we've been wanting. I would like to bring something back to the board and either get approval for us to make minor changes. At one time, the board allowed me to sign them and then put the final agreements on the consent agenda. We could do it that way without holding up developers. When sewer capacity began scarce, we started bringing up every single one of them to the board, but that hasn't always been the practice. But it would be helpful, especially on commercial and everything else, they really don't know until they do the final plan, to have some flexibility to adjust the number. We'd probably work with Ken to see what.
I'm okay with that. It's just got to be ratified.
Yeah, I mean, can we work on that in the future sometime?
Yeah, quite simply, if you were to bring us three, we're going to ask you questions anyways. You know better than we do. It's silly for us to.
Right now, we're treating these as contracts, and you have to do it. You know, we're not required to have a contract unless it's a pre-purchase and reserve and some of the other conditions. You don't sign a contract when you buy a water meter. And I can sell it if they walk in the front door and say, I want to tie in the sewer. We can sell them a tab there, and that doesn't come before the board. It's just the contract nature of it that you have to
throw it. I'd like if you look at some way in the future, you and Doug, or you, because it means to
for
hold
these
up.
Small add-ons, right?
Yeah, for add-ons, you know, we got plenty of sewer right now.
Would it be better to tie it to a percentage rather than a specific number of lots, to say not to exceed?
What?
Plus 5%.
Each one has a value, so
we can look at that future.
Tim, what are we charging for, I guess, per gallon or whatever the unit is?
This particular basin, when we sold this, it was going to Windermere. And 5130 plus 3,000 That's 4,050 is the normal tap fee we're charging. So at this time, Windermere would have been $19 a gallon, which would have been 5130. But they're entitled to get it at 4,050 by doing this advanced $3,000 payment. So you have to back into what the tap fee is today.
Okay, that answers your question.
Not too good.
Tell us, just tell us. Is there a motion from the board?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I would like to make a motion that we approve the sewer reservation agreement between Forsyth County and the Ryland Group for 810 gallons per day of sewer capacity for three residential lots, the Waterston Falls, James Creek Water Reclamation Facility, with the addendum on a time sensitive basis.
Second.
We have a motion and a second for a time-sensitive item on the sewer reservation. Is all in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carried. 5-0. Item 15, the agreement print for Scott County is no longer bound for sewer acquisition and payment schedule.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, this is an item that has a little bit of history to it. Going back to probably 2003, some of you may be familiar with No Longer Bound. They are a charitable institution here in the county that basically provides drug dependency treatment services. They have been in need of some sewer from the county and are, quite frankly, in need of some additional sewer from the county. Presently, they owe the county for 4,000 gallons of sewer, and quite frankly, to get, I guess you'd say, whole where they need to be, they need to buy an additional 2,500 gallons of sewer capacity per day. For a total of 6,500 gallons of sewer is what No Longer Bound needs. Their old agreement back from 2003 was for 4,000 or thereabout gallons of sewer. That agreement has never been perfected, as far as they have not made full payment for that capacity under that old agreement. So we need to not only get them current, but then they need to buy a little more. And I've tried to work with No Longer Bound. One of the things they do is they provide this drug dependency treatment for inmates or for individuals that are within the Forsyth County, I guess, court system right now. And there is value to the county because of what they are providing in conjunction with our court services. So here's what we have come up with. First of all, we need to get rid of the old contract. And when I say get rid of the old agreement, we need to do what's called a novation. Basically enter into a new contract that basically takes care of the old one and brings it all up to date. This agreement I have in front of you does that. Let me tell you what it does. The agreement in your agenda book, first of all, sells to No Longer Bound 6,500 gallons per day of capacity. Okay, that's a good thing. It takes away that old contract. It works in novation. Basically says, No Longer Bound, you're not traveling under that old agreement anymore. You're traveling under this agreement. All right? No Longer Bound wants to make payments to the county for their capacity. They are a drug dependency, basically men's treatment facility. Money is precious. We've been working with them, trying to figure out a way for them to be able to do this. They want to make payments to us over time. All right, well, this agreement, if you were to approve it, would allow them, first of all, to enter into an agreement to pay the county over time for that capacity. They would enter into a note with the county to make payments of $812 per month over a period of 120 payments. All right, with respect to interest over time for the payment over time, the county would give them credit for their continued willingness to accept up to 15 patients or inmates into their system at any one time. Let me make sure what the consistency is with respect to that. They have to accept at least 15 individuals into their facility per year from the county. All right, the county would give them credit for that as a means of foregoing formal interest for their payment over time for their capacity. Folks, this is the best we've been able to come up with. We've met with No Longer Bound a couple of times. They're good folks, but they're having difficulty coming up with the cash and the barrel head to pay for this capacity. So this is what we've got. We've got a sewer agreement, works as an ovation on the old agreement, enter into a promissory note with them to pay over time. And actually, we've even taken the additional step of one of the things you would be approving would literally be a memorandum of sewer acquisition. That's exhibit attachment 2 in your packet. We would actually record that in the clerk's office as, you know, binding in the chain of title. So that's the three things we're looking to do today. And again, all I can tell you is this has been a difficult situation, and this is the best I have got to be able to bring to bear to get No Longer Bound where they need to be.
Are there any interest payments?
No, you said it.
No, there's not. And that's, of course, the way we had to derive value of that was the amount of individuals they put through their system. We are imputing to them value per individual. They have to agree to take no less than 15 individuals from the county court system into their system a year. And they have confirmed to us that they do take individuals and will continue to do that. And they'll do it now by way of contract.
And does this set some precedent for, let's say, apparently we're looking at them sort of as a non-commercial group or not-for-profit or beneficial to
right.
Common good or some series of things like that.
Right.
Does this cause any problems for us down or someone who is more clearly a commercial venture?
For a commercial venture, I don't think so. I think for a commercial venture that's out there in the world of commerce and ostensibly making a profit, sure, I think we would have the ability to distinguish. But with respect to future nonprofits that may be seeking to acquire sewer, I think this may very well be held up to us and say, can you work with us just like you did No Longer Bound? Yes. Yes.
What recourse do you have if they fail to make the monthly payments?
To the extent they're a water customer, we would cut off their water.
Okay. So we got it tied to the water, so we
can do.
I mean, they got to pay for the sewage uses on top of the monthly.
Oh, this has nothing to do with the monthly bill. Yeah, they got to pay their monthly bill. This is the taps.
I know, but what if they don't pay the tap bill?
Cut off their water.
Cut off the water. We had to build, so we cut the water off. That's what I'm saying. So they got the monthly sewer usage plus this $812.50 on top of that.
Yes. Water. And, you know, the county has shown No Longer Bound a lot of grace. We're mindful of the activity they undertake in the community, but the county needs to do something along the lines of this.
Where's the operation located in?
Charlotte Shallow.
This organization also has a print shop to help.
I think they've got a print shop. I think they've got a little thrift shop over here on Dahlonega Highway, I believe.
I guess we're not allowed to advocate people using the print shop, are we?
We are not.
I won't do that then.
No, sir.
Any other questions? We have a motion from the board.
If, Chairman, I would move that we accept the agreement between Forsyth County No Longer Bound related to sewer acquisition. The payment schedule is presented to us by the county attorney.
Is that good enough, Ken, to have to say?
That's fine.
We have a motion and a second for the agreement between Forsyth County No Longer Bound related to sewer acquisition. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed?
Well, thank you, Ken, for all your hard work on that.
Yes, sir.
On to item 16, summary of proposed changes to the rezoning process.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman and members of the board. I'm back from the last time we had a discussion on potential changes to the rezoning process was back in October of 2012. And at that time, planning staff presented a draft that focused on streamlining certain components of the rezoning process. And just to review the main components of that draft, we reduced the number of applications from 2 to 1. We also changed when there was a major application change, it wouldn't automatically revert back to preliminary zoning review, which is step one. And we also streamlined the public participation report. Now, we did present that draft, as I said, back in October, and there was some board discussion at that time as to whether the board desired or wanted any elimination of standards. And we created that draft last fall under the board direction not to eliminate standards, but to streamline the process. So we're back today to get a firm direction from the board as to, you know, what you would like to see. We can bring the former draft back. We streamline the process. We can discuss today what elimination of standards could, you know, potentially be. We definitely want to, you know, ensure that the board is satisfied that we're moving on this item. So we do, if the board still wants changes to the process, we need to get, you know, in a public hearing schedule. But we need to know exactly if you want us to maintain the former direction of streamlining, or if you want us to move forward with potential elimination of standards. And I can discuss the draft in detail, or I can talk about the elimination of standards, whatever you need to
say. I have a question.
Sure.
Just being new and just being an observer of the meetings this past year, it seems like to me there is just an excessive amount of variance requests. And it appears to me that 95% or more, maybe it's closer to 100, of those variance requests get approved. And I go back to thinking along the lines of what Tim was talking about. I mean, what's considered a big deal that you guys could handle internally? And the second part, is if our UDC, if the board as a whole are going to approve all these variance requests, shouldn't we just change the UDC to make it in line, or in doing that, are they just going to come back and still ask for more?
Let me address the issue of administrative variances. The rezoning process changes and administrative variances were, two of several issues that the chamber brought to Doug and the planning department, and we have worked to address some of these issues sequentially. Now, the administrative variance issue is separate from what's under discussion today, but to let you know, we will be moving forward with a proposal for administrative variances that would take, a portion of those requests and put it on staff rather than it moving forward before the Planning Commission board. So that's something we could definitely go and get on work session agenda item. And it was coupled with this larger question about the rezoning process itself.
What you brought forward here is a full zoning process to look at how to streamline that without cutting into quality or the necessary steps.
That is correct.
That would sacrifice the quality products.
That is correct, and we wanted to revisit the discussion that took place in October, where there were some suggestions about looking at the standards themselves and maybe cutting a little more deeply into the process.
What standards would you like to see it eliminated or streamlined or something? What's your vision of that?
Well, I believe we in terms of planning staff's recommendation, it's in the memo here as far as streamlining the process. Now, a couple of one item, for instance, that was brought forward by Commissioner Bell at the previous October meeting was, for instance, we have a public signposting requirement for all our public hearings to be 25 days. The legal requirement is 15. So one of the questions on the table was, why not reduce that from 21 to 15 days? That's something that we could look at, but technically that is elimination of the current standard. That's something that's easy. If we wanted to cut more deeply, then we're really looking at the public participation process itself. By that, I don't mean public hearings. I mean the public participation meeting that the applicant holds and the report they have to generate. And then, of course, the participation of the Planning Commission. Those would be the likely components of the process if we wanted to look at standards. But our recommendation from the staff level remains as last time, which is streamlining the process again under that initial board direction of not actually cutting the process.
That 15-day notice, that state minimums?
Yes, and it coincides with the newspaper advertisement, which is at 15 days.
We've done a lot of aligning with state laws in a lot of different things. That's 2 years I've been working on this. I want to eliminate some of this.
That's one of the standards we have to eliminate. Then you get back to that type of public hearing about that too.
Well, any of these changes would require the standard 2 public hearings for UDC change, one for the Planning Commission.
Right now, there's really no push over. I mean, we are getting a few rezonings in.
Yes.
Is any push by the developers to make it go faster?
Well, this was really, these recommendations were an outgrowth of that conversation that, the chamber brought forward. Part of the discussion was, can we seek to streamline the process? And the feedback that I was getting from the developers as well as some other stakeholders was really looking at streamlining that public participation report, which the draft that we presented last fall certainly does that. It doesn't eliminate the requirement of a report. It doesn't eliminate the requirement of the public participation meeting, but it simplifies it. And the developers said that would be more in line with what they do in other jurisdictions, for instance. So I think this would be, if the board is interested and we move forward with streamlining the changes, I think this would be a very good time to do so because we're not overwhelmed with rezoning requests.
What about, is it still in place only 7 per month? That 7 number?
Yes, it is.
Is
for
that
for residential?
For residential,
yes.
Is that needed? I mean, while we're streamlining, I know we haven't had 7 of them.
I did discuss that with, we looked at every single thing we could put on the table when we first went to that. And unless the board directs us to, I don't believe that Tom and I saw a need to strike that at the same time. any requirement we have currently in the code is up for discussion.
Well, will this help take some of the red tape and time out of a new company coming here that the chamber may have convinced to come to our community?
It's not going to change the timeline because we still will have preliminary zoning review. It will still go before the planning commission. It will still go before the board. So, you know, of course, you have to meet your application and add deadlines. But what it will do is it will streamline the number of applications you actually have to submit. It will lessen the burden on the applicant for the public participation report. And it also means we have flexibility if there's a major application change. Right now, the way the code is written is there's not much discretion there. If you make that major application change, you have to start at step one again. This allows more flexibility with that, depending on the nature of the change. And so we've streamlined some things, and we've added flexibility in that area.
That would be the best. I personally, I like the sound of it. If it helps encourage business to come here and makes it a little less painful for them, and our community over others. Additionally, the 15-day aligning with the state law would be something I personally be interested in seeing other than 21 days. Anything to encourage some new business coming here, some additional growth.
And I kind of agree, Mr. Miller, about seven per applications per. I think we don't need to. We could look at doing away with that one simply because we're not that busy, but if we did get that busy, why? Then we'd have to have it take a longer process to do away with that. So why not just delete that now while we're thinking about it, hoping we do get busy.
Okay. We had talked, Tom and I had talked one time about looking at, and maybe it was through a meeting here, but that Cherokee County, in their process, they assign a planner that walks through the application from start to finish.
We really have, you know, as far as if someone comes in for a rezoning, a COP, a sketch plat, of course, Teresa serves as fundamentally our zoning administrator. She walks every applicant through the process, and of course, she is with them from start to finish.
Does she stay all the way through the LDP?
Not through LDP, but through the rezoning process or the COP or HOP. We have a different division that handles the development services aspect. So when someone comes in to pull a permit after they've been rezoned, it does fall under our current planning division, and another planner is assigned.
Any other comments by the board? So you're looking for direction right now. You're not just
that is correct. And what I have heard is that there are two additional changes going down for the public signposting from 21 to 15 days, the striking of the seven maximum residential rezoning applications per month, and then that being added to the former draft that we presented.
And you said the variances fall under something totally different.
That is a different process. We will be coming to you in a future work session on that. I'm working on that right now, and we'll be discussing the details of that with Tom Schiller.
Anything else?
My last question would be, do you want to see the draft again in a work session, or are you comfortable with it going to a public hearing for the planning commission?
Comfortable. I think we're pretty much laid it out here.
Okay. I'd like, if you will, send me a copy of it since it was from last time.
Yes, sir. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jim.
Thank you so much.
I did a great job on that. Item 17, the presentation. Preliminary draft related to the rest of reinvested rights issue.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, I will handle this in Tom's absence. This just pertains to an issue that we have more than a little experience in with respect to this board, and it pertains to the issue of vesting, and particularly where Tom Brown and I have seen this issue come up over and over and over again is within the context of vesting under the old Res 3 performance standards. Call. We've had this issue come up quite a few times. Tom and I have brought various things to the board. The board has always shown an express willingness to allow the development community, particularly if they got a zoning back prior to November 1st of 2007, Res 3 for 9,000 square foot lots, to let them continue with 9,000 square foot lots. Now, when we brought this to the board and were given direction to modify the code, here was the direction we were given. The direction we were given was if they got an old zoning under the pre-November 1st, 2007 Res 3 performance standards for 9,000 square foot lots and had acquired sewer that roughly approximated the number of units that property would have yielded, 9,000 square foot lots, and they haven't sought a refund, then let's go ahead and allow them to move forward with the 9,000 square foot lots. Okay, Tom and I were all happy to do that. We're preparing our UDC modifications. Well, then the whole Bethelview Talent matter came up. Remember that one? Okay, and that one was one where they had not purchased sewer, but I think they had run some sewer line, or they had spent some money, and the board seemed very comfortable going forward with that one as well. So let me just go ahead and say, the message that that sent was, again, what we'd really like to say is that if they got their zoning back before we changed the zoning performance standards back in 2007, let's let them proceed under those pre-November 1st, 2007 performance standards. I don't mean to get ahead of you. That may not be where you want to be, but that's what's in your book. We went ahead and just went that route because it just seemed time and time again the board really wanted to at least honor those old zonings and not really have us to get into weeds of vesting every time one of those issues came up. And that's perfectly fine. I just wanted to explain to you why this doesn't look exactly like the whole if you bought sewer and haven't requested a refund. I just didn't think that's where the board was. If you tell me that's where you are, of course we'll go back and we'll bring that to the Planning Commission. But if you're comfortable here, all this is it's got a table 11.2B and it's got your 14,500 square foot lots, and there's a note. And it says, by the way, if you were rezoned before November 1st, 2007, you can comply with the 9,000 square foot lot.
I truly think that's more in the way I agree with it, that these people, that we need to put the date and quit arguing, because actually they all bring up the vested rights, and this turns into us against them type of situation. So.
And basically you're saying because the Bethelview was approved, it set a precedent for everyone else.
To me, what it said is it expressed the view of the Board of Commissioners. Let's forget about vesting. If we want that to be the rule, just change our code. Make it clear. That gives the development community clarity. Everybody knows what we're doing. Let's don't make them or Tom and I have to dance on this issue and spend all this county money with me trying to figure out if they vested or not. Let's forget that. If that's where y'all want to be, it's easy. Just change the code to reflect it that way.
And doesn't this sort of bolster, though, an argument for speculative zonings? I mean, 2007 is a long time ago, and if they got their zoning and essentially hadn't completed their project by now, you know, it applies if you get a zoning and just hang on it.
That's the other side of the policy debate.
Yeah, but in all fairness, they haven't completed because the economy tanked.
No, I don't know why. So should we put that in there if the economy tanks?
No, just have the date on it.
Because I don't particularly agree with a lot of speculative zoning.
Well, I wouldn't say most of it was speculative zoning. Most of it was zoning that was going to be sold, and it fell through at the last minute.
I don't have any way to judge that, whether it was or not.
Would anybody consider listing five or six items that they develop and may have spent money on? And if they fit two or three of those, that helps get you there as well.
But then we get into the same thing of what if I spent money on something else? It's like the Bethview piece, they spent money on planning that. They had about $500,000 or more invested in their piece.
And they probably had a plat done.
They
already had their zoning done. Oh. And they had a contract that probably read contingent upon, and that would be satisfactory to those three items.
But I truly think we're about 90% through this rest three. Would you, Doug? I mean,
well, there can't be that many.
We don't have that many more.
Just going to let them all.
Just let them, you know, I spend money we can.
The only thing I'm not crazy about it, and this is if somebody buys it from the bank and wasn't the person to spend the money that zoned it, should they then also have it?
That's
the only problem I have. That's the only case I have a problem.
That may be why the bank is actually selling it, because it's the 9,000 square foot lots that people can make it work economically.
Which really makes it a more, I understand what you're saying, because you can't get them anymore anyway.
You can't get them anymore. We don't have that many left.
I got to tell you, just to grab it and flip it, I don't see it. But if you're the guy that's selling it all the time and have your money invested, I absolutely think you should have a right to have it invested right.
Thank the guy in the repo. He's been paying tax on all these years as a resident. The bank has been.
The bank lent the money
based upon that many lots.
Yes.
That's something they would have never got approved if it hadn't been for that.
Yeah. I mean, I wouldn't call it speculative zoning. I mean, people don't really speculate zoning that much with a 100-acre piece of land. They're going to turn it.
How many pieces are still sitting out there right now?
that may be looking for the vested rights that are left to vested. Do we have a number?
Tom and I discussed that, and I wish you were here. I seem to think the number is maybe more than 10, less than 15, something.
Yeah, we're down to the fire, to the middle now. We've got most of them, a lot of them have sewer already in place.
Mm-hmm. Right. Well, they have sewer. How can we not say the vested?
That's okay. It doesn't matter.
You're an attorney. You got to keep the thing going.
I'm just saying. There are arguments. It does get complex, Commissioner, yeah. Which is why there's some utility to making it more clear, because you know that we saw this over and over.
What I would love to know is if you have 10 to 15 left, how many of those do you suppose have sewer?
I don't know the answer. That's a good question.
That would help me a lot.
Yeah, but what? It's just it makes it more clear to the development community that we want to encourage you to buy these lots and start, let's get rid of them. Buy the sewer, buy the water. And if you have to spend 6 months on getting vested rights.
And we still have sewer available for all these?
Depends on where they are.
But if it's not, they're just at risk.
That's their problem, it's not ours. If they haven't pre-bought the sewer,
if we're going to predetermine this as vested, are we not getting ourselves in a little bit of trouble?
Okay, let's guarantee the sewer. We're not going to pre-declare that. I appreciate you bringing that up. We're not pre-declaring their vested.
Okay.
We are changing our code to recognize an entitlement. This takes vesting altogether out.
So this may help with our liability a little bit.
They're not vested. They simply have a code amendment.
That
sounds better to me.
So where are we headed, public hearing?
One more thing. That's the REZ 3 component. If you turn to the third page, do you see a reference to section 22-6.1, a lengthy paragraph, and in the middle of the paragraph you see a red sentence stricken? In the event a landowner filed and had approved an application for amendment to the official zoning map, the property-specific zoning approval, including the site plan submitted, govern the use and development of the property irrespective or regardless of whether the development approved through the rezoning process meets the terms of this code. That language is in there. You saw me grapple with this. Remember the Rockland Homes PowerPoint out in the big room where I had to raise this issue, and it's out there and we have to deal with it? Well, it is out there, and rather than pretend it's not there, we need to go ahead and address this, and quite frankly, I think Mr. Brown, if he was here, would say the same thing. We need to strip this out of here. This does not need to be in here, unless the board wants it in there, of course, but from an administration standpoint, this language is challenging for us.
Very challenging. Okay. So what would be our next step, Counselor, just to public hearing?
Just direct me and Mr. Brown to get this to a public hearing for Planning Commission.
So moved.
You have to have a vote or just direct?
Vote, please.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed? 5-0. Thank you, Counselor.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Jeff, I'll be back there. Item 18, alcohol ordinance procedures.
Mr. Chairman, this item, and I want to tee it up, and then I know that some other commissioners may have quite a bit to say on this. Two things, I believe, were primarily sort of leading to this discussion. Number one is what are some other jurisdictions doing, particularly within the realm of, number one, holding the hearings for new licenses, holding the hearings for renewal of licenses, and holding the hearings for discipline or sanctions of licenses. I don't think that I have to tell you this Board of Commissioners spends a lot of evening hours after most of the regular business on the agenda is done dealing with alcohol by way primarily of sanctions for licensees and servers. Mr. Brown, who would otherwise be discussing this with you, is not here today, but he has done some research on what other jurisdictions do with respect to how they handle the processing and the hearings, and it's a mix of things. Some jurisdictions handle new licenses by way of total administrative review and only tee it up for a full board review if there's a denial. Some of them have an independent licensing board that handles review of sanctions and penalties and things of that nature. Some of them do it just the way you do it. So that's one issue. And of course, I just throw this out there. We have sort of an all-purpose appeals board in Forsyth County. Now, to be fair, we call it the ZBA, the Zoning Board of Appeals, but they handle appeals from other things. And so we have a body out there that might be able to handle some of the work that y'all are handling right now. So just think about that. The next issue, taking away the side of how we're processing the licenses and the permits, is the amendments. We do a lot of ordinance, alcohol ordinance amendments every year right now. In fact, there have been times where we may literally have had two or three amendments in the hopper at one time in various levels of being in the hopper. And I know that it's just near and dear to some board members to at least talk about that and see whether that may be the ideal way to handle alcohol. So, I mean, I don't mean to limit it, but I can think of two issues that are big right now. One is, who's hearing the alcohol licenses and the penalties? And number two, do we do a little more than's necessary on the amendment process? And I'll offer it up back up.
Tom and I talked about this. We talked about it several times, and I've talked to y'all as well, to staff about it. We talked about how limited staff is in dealing. It's taking one employee to deal with just alcohol all the time, and how much Tommy's even configured how many dollars we have sitting up at a commissioner's meeting, and how we could do that much more efficiently, cost efficient wise as well. Actually, Tim Merritt, when we were doing, I sat in on the agenda review, and Tim came up with the idea of the possibility of using the zoning board appeal, because different counties actually use the board more broadly and did not just make it be just an alcohol advisory board that handled those type issues that basically have the same, you know, they're very redundant lots of times in the way that they're dealt with. And they just changed, they called it different things, but it was like Ken said, an appeals board. So there is the one issue to deal with the things that take up so much time at the commission meeting. There is the second issue about how many do we want to leave it just the same the way it is now. We changed the alcohol ordinance. I think Tom said there were 17 changes done last year, but he said half of those came from the state of Georgia on changes they made, and he was hopeful that most of those have been done. But public hearings are costly, and they do cost the county a lot of time and money. I know Doug mentioned when we were talking about it how onerous the manual, the alcohol ordinance is, and how it needed to be condensed and be more user-friendly. So that's like a third component to do with alcohol. Tom mentioned that right now we don't charge any fee to servers when they get their license, and that other counties do, and that he thought that was one reason we have 8 to 10 people waiting in line a lot of days, because we charge nothing and people come in and get them and don't consider, it's not the restaurant, these are your servers. And he also wanted to add in some of this to start charging a fee for, I mean, just because it's costing his department so much time and money.
Are you suggesting that they're coming in to get that and they don't necessarily have a job?
They might not even have a job. I mean, they might not. And that it would discourage, you know, Tom was thinking $40, but that would be up to the board. But he thought that was in general about what.
Have a fee to keep it to people that really have a job and really want it.
And then that would want to hang on to it. So there's several components about alcohol. Tom just wants direction from us. Do we want him to come back with more specifics to give him, you know, this is what it would take to turn this over to a zoning, to change the zoning appeals to just an appeal board, and to start doing some of that in-house, you know, rather than the way we're doing it now?
The only question I have is the zoning appeals board, if we turn it to an alcohol board, it's going to run the same problem we have of after hours having staff there to review these things. Because unless we change the hours or ask the zoning appeal board to meet during the day, that I'd like to see it during the day some point.
Well, and Tom said we could look at that. He said that he could look at that more closely to see. He believes that that might be a possibility.
It's a possibility. Jim talked to those 5 members to see if they had a job.
Well, no, and also talked to 5 members to see if they wanted to devote that kind of time to this board. I mean,
I agree with you. It'd be a separate meeting, probably. Would you agree?
Well,
you wouldn't combine them, would you?
If you done a board of appeals, you could You could be like our board, just have an agenda, and you do it.
You could do it on the same evening as the zoning related ZBAs, but you still get into the overtime issue.
Do those members get paid per meeting?
They would get, to the extent we pay them a per diem, it would be the same per diem.
Same per diem. And is it fair to ask them to put in three times the time for the same per diem?
Well, that's where you have to talk to them.
You'd have to talk to them, but Tom could gather that information. I mean, it's, I mean, he could look at it if you, instead of doing it, don't y'all just hear it, I mean, one time a month?
First, yes.
And it could be that.
Maybe they, maybe let them do twice and separate these out.
Well, in my mind, it's.
And I would agree, you need to find out exact, here's the questions I would need to know. What they get paid, whether or not it's gonna require an extra meeting or not by them, how many of them could do in the daytime or not, how many staff members have to be there, who they have to be, what Tom believes the numbers are that we are spending now at night with us, and what it would cost overall for them, what the difference is. And if it, and if there's a savings, I mean.
But he was, that was the whole point. He just needed direction to gather more specifics and to get back with the board on it.
I like the idea of charging server money.
I do sure.
Everybody else does.
I didn't realize we weren't charging application.
I don't know, 40 might be a bit much.
40's a little.
Yeah, I think 25 might be something to deter about.
Whatever, Tom can figure that out.
So y'all would like to hear more from Mr. Brown on the specifics, primarily of cost savings that might be enjoyed by going to.
And the cost to change to charge applicants.
I have also a question. If we were to use a group that already exists, such as the ZBA, but not necessarily the ZBA, is that two meetings? Is that one meeting? Is that two groups, but the same people?
We'll just have to wait for Tom to get back.
I think it would depend. I mean, I think if they have to reassemble again any other day except their normal meeting date, that would be two meetings. But I mean, y'all could go up on the per diem if you think that they can consolidate it into one meeting, but it's going to be double the time. Could raise their per diem. I mean, you can do whatever you need to do to make it attractive to them.
We absolutely know how long those meetings take. We're out there sometimes an hour to 3 hours.
And part of that, I mean, on my park and rec board years of service, I didn't ever look at it like I was doing it for the money. I was doing it to serve the community. There were times that I would have 4 or 5 meetings a month. I only got paid my $48.
That's what I mean. You need to have a discussion with them before we ask them to do
it. Right.
If they lose their form for the first meeting, they've lost it.
That's correct.
That type of stuff.
Yes, sir.
And Tom, in all fairness, this idea was just thrown out last week or when we did the agenda review, and he's got to do research and get everything together. He just needed direction. I mean, he was going to come and ask for a board for just the alcohol, but then when Tim had the idea that the zoning appeals board, I mean, Bettina told me last month, I think they heard 3 appeals and it took 30 minutes. She said it was, you know, they're not, it's not like they're covered up.
But the only thing I'm just, is just the cost of having the same thing after our work, if they get involved with this.
Doing it during the day. And Tom was, I know that he was hopeful that he could do it during the day with his staff. Alcohol portion, so it'll
certainly,
be a matter of
Miss Bills, if they're getting such a small amount of money to these meetings once a month, they must, most of them got to have jobs.
Well, even
tired.
Even though we've all done those retired still work.
Yeah.
So is that enough direction for you, Counselor?
It is, sir. I've got one.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you, sir. On to item 19, the appointment to the member of Georgia Mountains Regional Commission. County Manager?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, Mr. Board, item 19. Is just what you said. It is the appointment to the GMRC, Georgia Mountains Regional Commission Council, and the current structure of this is the chairman or his or her designee serves while in office. At this time, Commissioner Boff is a member of this council. I wanted to bring this to the board to determine the recommendation if you would like to continue to have Mr. Boff, Chairman Boff serve, or if this board would like to make a change in that membership.
Bob, you good? Don't care about that. Well, since this is the chairman or his designee, I'm planning on going to the ARC meetings. John and I went to my first one in January, and I plan on keep going to those. And I believe Commissioner Tam expressed a desire to do this one. He knows a lot of those buildings. So I'd like to make a nomination. We nominate Brian Tam to fill this Georgia Mountains Regional Commission Board.
Yes, sir.
Any questions?
Just a, when was the last time somebody went to one?
I've not gone to a lot of them. I think once or twice I got a substitute. They had one around Christmas that I went to, so that was the last one.
I think it's important we have somebody go. We spent, last year, I think we spent almost $190,000 in civil work.
And I'm pretty sure that your desire to, we need to have somebody, because
somebody
went to ARC meeting, they were real appreciative. Not saying that we did anything wrong, but they said we need to have somebody there at every meeting. So.
I guess my question is, what was the value we got for them?
Well, we didn't get any last year.
We need somebody to sit on this board and report back to us. So we have a motion and a second. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Item 20, consideration of amendment to the Forsyth County 911 of Center Advisory Board.
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. At the November 8, 2012 911 Advisory Board meeting, the members of that board agreed unanimously to request that I come before the Board of Commissioners and ask you to consider an amendment to the current resolution and eliminating the requirement to meet quarterly.
How does the law read on that?
It does not designate the number of times to meet.
Because I thought we read it in there at one time, unless that's what the chance of sir. I thought it was once a quarter is what the law said, I thought.
We've researched it, and there's...
I think that used to be in our...
It was our code.
Our policy said that, yes, sir.
It was our policy when we did this board, we said once a quarter, no more.
Only how often do you think they need to meet?
Well, the recommendation from this board is in your book, and it replaces the current language with this. The Forsyth County 911 Center Advisory Board shall meet no less than once per calendar year at a date to be determined by the Advisory Board Chairman, which is Chief Bowman at this point, and may otherwise hold any additional meeting as are deemed necessary to carry out the business of the board. Forsyth County 911 Advisory Board shall comply with State of Georgia Open Meetings Act.
Do these board things have to be advertised for Georgia meeting?
They do.
Okay. Do you feel comfortable once a year or more?
Recommend do pass.
Very good. I have one question. Well, there are, I guess they have, to keep up with the needs of each agency that deals with the 911 center. Tell me if I'm missing this somehow. The sheriff has a liaison. I believe your office has some liaisons.
The sheriff himself.
Yeah. No, not for this one. I'm talking about the protocol meetings they have once a month downstairs. Looks like the 911 director's there. There's typically one, if not two, fire representatives there. There's at least one, if not two, sheriff representatives there.
CPD.
Yeah. And they have a protocol of what each other needs, what's been going on, who can help you with what changes they need for the future. And I've sat in two of those just to hear and see somebody suspecting views and see what they're actually doing. It seems like it's almost the exact same thing that this does, but the question is, does this committee understand what they're doing down there, what their needs are, since this, by law, is supposed to be a committee that understands the needs of the 911 center? It's just kind of just, does that information carry to this group?
Does the information, yes.
From the protocol meetings carries up to it?
Yes. They're building the watch downstairs in the 911 center. They bring it upstairs and we approve it.
And if they meet once a month, I guess my question is once a year enough to take care of their needs to approve it?
That board, 911 board, is so inclined to leave me as chair, I would call the meeting.
As needed?
Yes, sir.
That's excellent.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
The last meeting that we had, Brian Tam, bless his heart, he came up for a 5-minute meeting.
I got you.
That's a waste. The chief of police is there, the sheriff's there, Miss Tisdale's good enough to come up, and there was no business.
Very good.
Waste her time.
Yeah, I just didn't know that. But they have the protocol meetings there every month. It lasts about an hour. It's a lot of information they're talking about. I'm just curious what more that doesn't make it back to your board.
If they had a change in protocol that all the agencies fire, PD, and SO needed, I'd call the meeting. But we haven't had any in quite some time, so.
This resolution gives you the authority to call any meeting.
It does, Mr. Chairman.
I believe that this, the law that was written now requires the 911 advisory committee, as if it's not under the sheriff. And it's also for the purpose of gathering what the needs are, future needs are, financial as well, for the 911 center. So as long as you're comfortable, they bring you enough information, because you have liaisons there, obviously, they share with you.
Yes, sir.
That you bring it forward, I love that work for me.
Yes, sir. It's just us getting away from the mandate quarterly.
Gotcha.
We may have to have a quarterly meeting because we need to vote on the new chair, the will of the board, that board.
Gotcha.
The 911 board.
Very good.
Any other questions? Do I hear a motion?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I would move that we approve the consideration of the change of amendment to the Forsyth County 911 Center Advisory Board Resolution as presented by the county manager.
Have a motion, have a second.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve the amendment to the Forsyth County 911 Center Advisory Board. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 5-0.
Thank you, Commissioners.
Thanks, Chief.
Thanks, Chief.
Do a great job.
Thank you.
Item 21, resolution to update the scope of the jail courthouse parking facility project in order to ensure compliance.
Mr. Chairman, thank you. This is a matter we touched on briefly at the last work session. You recall that the program manager and the architect came and put on a PowerPoint and showed some of the different configurations of the jail and courthouse facility. Well, I think I had mentioned to you that I would be bringing something back to you to sort of belt and suspenders what we were talking about doing. Okay, we all know that as we were leading up to the SPLOST vote and the bonding associated with the SPLOST vote, we had some concepts of how the downtown was going to look. And there were two primary things that I want to bring to your attention. Number one is that we had the parking deck on the same parcel as the courthouse. It was to the rear of it, but it was going to be on the same parcel. In addition to that, we had at least provided some preliminary information to suggest that we were going to save what we could of the existing jail and basically expand it. All right, well, both of those things have changed. So let me just say this, the total scope of what we were doing downtown is of course the same. We are building a jail and a courthouse and parking facilities downtown, overwhelmingly using the property that's right across the street from us. However, rather than build a parking deck facility to the rear of the courthouse, for a host of reasons, we are going to probably split up the parking facility, one parcel being perhaps on this end of the, oh great, okay, well Doug's got some concept art. One parking facility being on this side, and perhaps another parcel being on the side near Tyson's for parking. In addition, you probably recall our project program manager coming to you and saying that from a cost standpoint, trying to add on to the existing jail made no fiscal sense, and that the best thing to do was to raise the jail to its foundations and build a new one. All right, well, the resolution I have in front of you is not pursuant to the SPLOST law, because quite frankly, the SPLOST law anticipates that a board has to have reasonable flexibility to make modifications. The revenue bond law does too. The bond laws that address how we are financing this, they anticipate that as well. But I have an abundance of caution. It just seems to me we are changing enough where I believe you might want to deal with those protocols that says this. To the extent that in a bond election there is a reference
Excuse
to...
Excuse me, Ken, one second.
Go ahead.
To be polite to Ms. Tisdale, not waste her time driving up here, can she move to the front so she can see the layout?
Yeah, she can move temporarily over.
Thank you, Chairman.
The statute provides that for a bond election, to the extent there contains a reference of brochures, listings, or advertisements issued by the governing body of a county, those are deemed to be statements of intentions of what we intend to build, all right? But the law also anticipates that whenever, after the bonds have issued, to the extent that needs to be changed You can change it, and one of the reasons you can change it is if circumstances have changed such that the expenditure of all or a part of the bonds is no longer practicable or feasible. Well, that's only roughly captured here, because the reality is we're spending the money for the same exact thing we told the voters we'd spend the money on, but we are changing where, and so again, really, I'm leaning forward really far to do this. But I really believe the more cautious approach is to go ahead and adopt a resolution authorizing this change. We then run that in the newspaper. We have to run it in the newspaper, and I'll handle all of that. It does have to be approved by a 4/5 or supermajority vote to authorize this change. And I believe at the last presentation, I believe Mr. Dare is, I think that's where he wants to be. I think we are embracing what we call the town green concept. Is that the concept that anticipates?
The town green you've seen before is behind you there, and that was shifting the courthouse back, displacing the parking deck. And I'm going to go back to what Ken said earlier. The original concept is what you see here. This is what you saw early on when the discussions plus 7 in this project came to the public. This is the section of the jail that was going to try to be saved, if you will. This is actually the jail as it's at least conceptually designed today. And then this is actually a future expansion. So that's what, as Ken said, that's what you saw conceptually to get to the point where this board could determine a cost estimate for the project. Since the time the board, both the jail courthouse project team and this board, agreed to move forward with the town green project or concept, that required some changes in parking. What it did, it took, again, the courthouse from where it was here, fronting this road, pushed it back, moved the parking deck, if you will, to this location with an option to be this location as well. And again, the jail courthouse project team, as well as this board, has seen this. The jail courthouse project team recommended the board to go with what we called option 3, which was 2 parking decks. One here, accommodating about 430 to 480 vehicles or spaces, and then a space parking deck in this area to accommodate anywhere from 220 to 250 parking spaces.
And I may have mentioned at the last work session that a public hearing would be required. It will not be required. That was my mistake. The statute doesn't require that. It requires a resolution and then publication in the legal organ, which I will handle.
And can there be a charge to the user for the parking spaces?
Yes, I believe there could be. I don't think the bond of the SPLOS law would prohibit that.
Is that question related to the county or city?
Anybody who uses parking spaces paid for by SPLOS dollars.
Any other questions from the board?
Are we asking to approve the 2 parking sites here?
You are being asked to approve that concept, yes. Okay. Yes.
And I just want to tell you that this is not to assume that this board and the city of Cumming has come to terms with respect to the using the city property as a parking deck. That's still something we've got to work on.
So what happens if we approve this and then can't come to terms, Ken?
We approve something else.
Well, all this is saying is, let me just, if you will bear with me one more second, under section 1 on page 3, here's what you're approving. Section 1 says change in circumstances. Pursuant to the advice of experts, like you heard our program manager and others say, the board has concluded as follows. It would result in a more aesthetically pleasing result if plans related to the construction of the courthouse, detention center, and parking facilities are adjusted to add more green space in front of the courthouse, thereby requiring the relocation of related parking facilities to nearby downtown parcels. B, it would be less expensive if plans related to the construction of the courthouse, detention center, and parking are adjusted to raise the existing detention center and replace the new facility at the same location. And C, It would be impractical to construct the courthouse, detention center, and parking facilities according to the concept plans originally contemplated in the informational materials published prior to the adoption of SPLOST. My point is, you're not agreeing where those related parking facilities would go. You're simply acknowledging a deviation from that concept art that may have, in fact, been provided to the voters before the vote. That's all. And you're saying we have now the flexibility to adjust those to some nearby parcels. You're not agreeing where they're going to go.
We still have the option to put them where you want to.
Yes, sir.
Is there any other questions from the board? A motion from the board.
This would be time sensitive.
Yes, sir. I make a motion. We approve the resolution by the Board of Commissioners of Forsyth County, Georgia, regarding the use of SPLOST and bond funds for the jail courthouse project as presented by County Attorney. Time sensitive.
Second.
Time sensitive.
We have a motion and a second to approve item 21 as a time sensitive item. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 5-0. Ms. Tisdale?
Yes, Chairman Amos, thank you very much.
Mr. Chairman, next item.
Item 22, discussion of Forsyth County enabling legislation and possible revisions.
Mr. Chairman, thank you. I just want to walk you through. In your agenda packet, you'll actually see this is the Forsyth County enabling legislation. And it is actually at MuniCode, so you can go to MuniCode and you can find it there. But this is an amalgamation of all the various local laws that have been enacted since the county came into existence. And these are obviously some dated laws that nonetheless, from time to time, we ought to bring out and we ought to modify to make sure they are consistent. I don't mind telling you, a lot of these have become rather old. And quite frankly, there is general law. When I say general law, I'm talking about statutes that have statewide uniform application that are in conflict with some of these. And so as we do with all of our other rules and regulations and ordinances and statutes, it sometimes is helpful to go through here and try to clean these up. And as you know, under the 1983 Georgia Constitution, boards of commissioners have the authority under what's called the home rule power. We have the authority to amend our own enabling legislation. We've done it before and we can do it again. I just wanted to walk you through some of these. All I'm seeking at the end of this is your permission for me to bring back basically a modified version of the enabling legislation that cleans some of this up to make it consistent with state law. Number one, all of y'all got some yellow highlighting on there? Good. Okay, the first one on page one, you'll see where it talks about the creation of the county. And then it talks about on or after January 1st, 2003, the chairperson shall be elected as provided in Section 2 of the Act. Section 2 of the Act doesn't address how the chairperson is elected, so I need to modify that section as well. Again, just these things get modified over the course of years, and things that made sense make sense no longer. If you go to page the next page where there's some yellow, I guess would be Section 7. Section 7, I've actually highlighted the language pertaining to the Board of Commissioners' salary. Now, first of all, before any rumors start, I'm not advocating the Board of Commissioners' salary be changed at all. I'm simply proposing to you that when the Board of Commissioners last changed its salary, there was more to the change than just is in that section, and I think that may be more of a MuniCode problem than a problem from the county, but I want your permission to reach out to them. They need to make sure that all of the nuts and bolts of what you actually modified in the resolution changing your salary is in there. There was more to it than just a dollar figure. Okay, and so I need to change that as well. Section 8 under regular meetings, it says that the regular meeting may be called by the chairman or by the other four members of the board. I don't understand that. The other four members of the board, does that mean the other four members acting collectively? If that means collectively, then that would be an open meetings problem. If it means individually, then that means something altogether different. I don't know what the other four members of the board means. I think we need to look at that. Okay. With respect to Section 11, you have the ability to employ a clerk to the Board of Commissioners. That's great. You will pay her $2,400 a year to a maximum of $4,200 a year. Again, it's an old law. I mean, this was
silly.
Right, so.
How do you feel about that?
Is that a raise for you?
I think she got scared. I think you were scared.
If you look at section 12, your powers generally, one of the things it provides to you is the ability to audit the books of the county treasury, fine, the county depository, fine, the tax commissioner, that's fine, the sheriff, that's fine, the superintendent of public schools. Obviously, general law, they have their own audit requirements. They are audited every year. We don't audit their books. Again, I just want to bring you back something that at least addresses the reality of the situation. Number two, under the police powers, 12.1, on the next page, you'll see that with respect to how we adopt ordinances, this law doesn't even require they be subject to public hearings. We do public hearings. We allow public comment. These, in fact, only require them to be read. Being read is not a public hearing. Being read is basically discussed and we go over them, but I think that we need to embrace public hearings in this law. So I'd like to change the section dealing with how we adopt ordinances to make it consistent with what I think are our more exacting rules. We do have our public hearings at two consecutive public hearing calendars. We don't adopt misdemeanors. This law anticipates that we adopt misdemeanors. We don't adopt misdemeanors. We adopt codes, and we don't hold someone liable for a misdemeanor. They are guilty, if anything, of a code violation. Boards of commission don't adopt misdemeanors. It's a state law function. With respect to the board to serve as the purchasing agent, I'd like to take a look at that in light of our purchasing policies. I think on some components of Section 14, we are actually more rigorous than the local law, on some less so. I'd like to harmonize that with the fact that we've got a nice, meaty purchasing policy that is perfectly consistent with Georgia law, but I would like to take a look at Section 14 pertaining to our purchasing. Section 18 on financial statements, I'll defer to David Gruen on this. It says the board shall have prepared semi-annually by CPA a condensed statement showing the financial condition of the county, which statement shall be published semi-annually in a newspaper. I think that there is, in fact, a general law that requires when we are to be audited and what the results and what must occur with respect to that audit. But I just want to raise that to you to say I think that's another area where our local laws may be inconsistent with the general law of statewide application. Okay. Number 19, the chairman shall elect one regular day each week and shall remain in the office of the admin building of said county, presumably that entire day. Mr. Commissioner Amos, regrettably.
You're not going to change it, are you?
Yeah, we might want to look at that.
I'm going to have to be here one day?
All day.
All day.
All day.
One day.
Yeah, I think we're
going to change it.
I would like that, by the way.
Let's give it 3 days.
Lunch?
And then finally, just section 21, the board shall keep in constant touch with the office of the State Highway Department. Constant touch, I don't even know what that means. Constant touch, I'm sure that the author knew what that meant years ago. And the State Highway Department probably doesn't exist so much anymore. So again, you see what I need to do. Do I have everyone's authority to bring back some modifications to these?
First, I'd like to commend your law office for doing this. I'd like to ask, how do you find all this stuff?
What do you mean?
It's been on the books for years, hasn't it?
County government is a work in progress.
Yeah, I'm
the chairman.
That's right.
I'm not going to say it. It's motivation.
What's he been doing with all his time?
I don't know. That's my point I was getting to.
I understand. I typically don't do anything during the day. I just stumble upon this. No. Well, I'd raise it to you.
But there are you in your office.
See, it's getting late already. Do you need a motion or just direction?
No, why don't you go ahead and make a motion that just have me go out and bring back some modifications to the local laws consistent.
Can you just redact this?
No, I'll be changing it to reflect what we do now and what the general law of the state of Georgia is.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve the enabling legislation and revised by our esteemed council. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Carried is 5-0. Item 23, the consideration of a county ordinance to regulate the sale of tobacco paraphernalia to minors. Commissioner Levin.
Now. Ken, you want to touch on that?
Sure, members of the board, this is actually sort of the other shoe to drop. Remember we did the SPICE and the K2 ordinance? And you may recall the discussions we had around this table pertaining to how we were able to address something that is in fact regulated by state law. You may also remember we had to be very careful how we address something regulated by state law, because county governments are not able to make illegal that which is already illegal by state law. Therefore, we had to basically come up with a code that said that to the extent that state law did not regulate the chemical composition of a certain compound, but that it was intended to emulate a synthetic cannabinoid, remember that? Basically a synthetic marijuana, we would regulate there. This is very similar. This gets to the notion of drug paraphernalia, all right? And if you go to some various vendors in the county, you may be able to go to a certain rack and look in that vendor, and you will see things that look to be some sort of aids to assist in the smoking of either marijuana or tobacco or some product. And it's all completely legal. Well, no, let me scratch that. It's all completely available for sale. It would appear to be illegal under state law, and there is a state prohibition specifically on those sorts of things with respect to marijuana and related intoxicants. So how could we address it if we wanted to allow more of a local regulatory enforcement? Well, it's very much like K2 and SPICE. We can't. We can't regulate. We can't make it illegal because state law already makes it illegal. However, we can address the sale of smoking paraphernalia to minors. That's something that is not addressed specifically by state law. It is how other jurisdictions have addressed this very problem. And I think this is something that some of the board members feel is worthy of taking on and trying to address the issue. And so my job was to try and come up with an ordinance that dealt with the prohibition of the sale or distribution of tobacco paraphernalia to minors. It is a hole in the state regulatory scheme that perhaps the county could fit into. And it would at least give us some weapons if we wanted to be able to go out there and take a look at merchandisers who are selling what is clearly some sort of paraphernalia for smoking, to aid in smoking, and at least attempt to make it as difficult for this stuff to get into the hands of minors as possible.
Ken, a couple of questions for you, please.
Yes, sir.
Is it possible to have a permit fee like you do for alcohol licenses of $100 or $200 or any amount of money? And with that, is it possible to add in there if they have caught for two violations? That they lose that license right to sell these items?
Okay, I don't know. I don't know the answer to that very fair question.
Trying to get a little more weighted. And I did speak with Sheriff Piper about this twice. He read what you wrote, and he was absolutely supportive of this. So.
Well, that's what we need to find out, because I don't think we went through all that stuff last time, and I don't think the sheriff,
I spoke with him twice, he even forwarded this last week.
I thought the ex-sheriff, I don't think he ever enforced it.
We have, Mr. Chairman, we have our first SPICE K2 enforcement action coming up.
Yeah, the current sheriff or the vice sheriff?
I don't know. I don't know if it's up the current or park. I don't know.
Okay.
When's the case supposed to come up?
Probably February.
So is this a true hole in state law, or are we just
trying to get this out of our store?
It's an area where I think we could survive a challenge on.
But they still can leave it out as long as they don't sell anybody under 18, correct?
Yes.
And that would
and
be part
we can't
of the
ask them to put it behind the counter.
That's what the sheriff asked also, is can we possibly get it? Do they have to? In other words, once you permit it, they have to get a license to sell the stuff. They have to have a permit. In that permit, to set some rules as if you have to hide it behind the counter or not having the public eye for all minors to see. And if you're found selling it underage twice or once or whatever, we decide to put in there, can you then pull their permit where they're not allowed to sell it anymore?
Let me, before I just pop off an answer, let me tell you why I'm grappling with this, because it's an issue of preemption. Preemption is simply if the state's spoken to it, we don't get to also speak to the same issue. So I don't want to mislead. Let me look at the licensure requirement, the permit requirement, a fee requirement, and a behind-the-counter requirement and bring it back to you.
We can't make it harder than the state, can we?
Typically we can make it harder than the state, but if they already make it a criminal offense, I don't think we can make it more criminal.
But did you say, Todd, that Kennesaw has
Is this where you got this from?
I said this. This is Ken Saul's approach, yes.
Yeah, and they've been, apparently it's been working there. That's why you brought it forward.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay.
I'll bring something back.
Bring something back.
Thank you, Ken.
Yes.
On item 24, consideration of provisions of the South Carolina Sewer Refund Policy regarding restocking fee. Commissioner Tang.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, this is just an issue actually that surfaced by way of a citizen that had acquired sewer and is now seeking a sewer refund. The citizen, I believe, may have come to Water and Sewer and then came to me. Fortunately, and I think admirably, they heard the same thing at both locations. Here's what they were asking for. They had purchased sewer. I believe it was a little more than 50. Well, I don't know what the original sewer purchase was. What happened was, however much they purchased, when the subdivision finally needed that sewer, they only needed some of it, meaning they had some left over and didn't need it anymore. So they wanted to sell it back to the county under the county's sewer refund policy. The amount they had to sell back was worth around $50,000 or so. Unfortunately for them, because they had held the sewer longer than 2 years, our sewer refund policy states that there is a 10% restocking fee, which means that although subject to certain criteria, the county may in fact be willing to buy it back, but we're going to take $5,000 off of it because of just the administrative cost and the cost attendant upon the fact that for the whole time they had that sewer contract, we had to make that sewer available to them for a while, you know, because while we were under contract, if they'd asked for it, we had to give it to them. So it's a 10. So this individual came to Mr. Perkins, and basically Mr. Perkins said, look, there's a policy, and I'm not authorized to deviate from the policy, and that's a 10% restocking fee. This individual came to me, heard the same thing, and just as candidly as I can say it, the only reason or only way you can give this individual some relief would be to change your policy, to either carve out an exception for either perhaps an individual that maybe, you know, set a dollar amount, perhaps that if the sewer refund is for this amount or less, no restocking fee will be charged or assessed. I think we did do one previous modification of our sewer refund file policy based upon a restocking fee. Some of you, other than Ms. Mills, may remember this one. It involved a piece of property way up in the northern part of the county, where the sewer doesn't even flow to Forsyth County. It flows to like the Dawson Basin, and they had another eligible buyer that wanted to put septic system, and so we carved out this very narrow exception and allowed them to get a 100% refund. Same sort of thing would apply here, as this would be an exception to our policy, and if this individual is going to get any relief, this is where it would have to come from this board. Y'all would have to carve out an exception in your policy.
What was the reason that they didn't need whatever they originally purchased?
Just because between perhaps the concept plan and between the final plat and the actual plat. I mean, Tim, you may know. I mean, I'm speculating.
I don't know that it's ever explained.
Sometimes they just lose lots.
They just bought more than they needed. I believe this particular development, though, there was a period of time we had other people. This is the one around Old Atlanta Club. We had to turn people away. I believe the daycare across the road, there were several that this was a commodity because there wasn't any more. And they held on to it until they absolutely didn't need it, and nobody else needed it either.
Well, how much did they pay in that date and time? 15, 16, 19?
Yeah, 15 to 19 is what most of them. I didn't know this was about a particular. I knew this instance, but I didn't know that's what this agenda item was about.
It sounds like we've lost revenue over this time frame by not letting somebody else have it.
Well, the other thing that happens is, as soon as you're out of capacity, you go to start building sewer plants and buying sewer plants and doing other things, because we've got a commitment to deliver it. So if there's a problem, if everybody who bought sewer capacity now came back to you and says, I don't need it now, after we've, you know, maybe gone out and bought capacity from Fulton County or from somewhere else to make sure you provide it. So,
have we charged other people this?
On yes.
The restocking fee?
Uh-huh.
Yes, ma'am.
You've had one, since you put it in place, you've had one.
We've also given exceptions.
But how do you determine who gets an exception?
Well,
The policy is very clear, and this individual did not fit under the policy.
For me, a possible consideration would be if they pay a lesser dollar, then we can now sell it for them, and we can recover some funds that way. So I don't know what they paid for it and what they would now sell it for.
Yeah.
For somebody else.
I'm not 100% sure which basin and where this her capacity is. I do know that we facilitate the sale if there are other people out there who are willing to buy it. We try to line them up, and then that way they can get their full dollar for dollar if they can find somebody who wants it.
Is there any way to get that information for us if we put this to the end of the agenda?
Sure.
Do y'all mind?
Well, the end is just about. That's not that long.
He may be able to make a phone call downstairs, and they can pull it.
I think we've got a spreadsheet downstairs. I can go get all the ones you approved.
And if you're gonna look at it, then how much? What capacity did they buy? How large project was this?
Yeah. We'll just put it on the next work session.
Madam Chair, I'd encourage you to figure this out. Either way, it doesn't matter. I mean, I'd just love to have those answers before I vote.
I don't think they're that big a hurry.
She was approved for this
long time ago.
Many months ago for the refund, and then through the forms that needed to be signed, it's drug on, and then she told us to process it, but then at the last minute, she decided she wanted to go see.
When she filled out the original forms months ago, was she within her 2 years then?
No.
Okay.
I'll move we just put it on the next work session.
I'll start with that.
February 12th, the next work session. Have a motion and a second to move to February 12th work session. We have a motion. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. 5-0. Item 25, the discussion of need to update the mitigation feasibility report for county owned property. This county attorney.
When we met with the park and rec people to go over the north parks, we were looking at Old Federal Road and different, and this come right after us having to make that settlement, such a large amount. And I asked the question, do we know what we possess in buying all the green space property as far as what mitigation, do we have a mitigation bank? Do we know how much it would cost to do one versus and how much it would be worth if we did it? I also asked if we had one in place, could we have possibly used that to negotiate with future lawsuits to be able to trade those mitigation credits? And so Tim Merritt was in on the meeting, and he suggested that he didn't remember at the time that you had a study done, was it 2011 or
2009,
but we know of several pieces that have been bought. The Halt Creek was one that has never been looked at, and we just thought that it would be good for the board to give direction to not go into a study, but just to get a cost analysis of how much would it cost to actually do a bank and how much it would be worth to do it, to see if that's something that the county we should pursue. Does that make sense?
How much money would to me is just a little bit?
Just to refresh your memory a little bit, back in 2009 we evaluated 53 properties in the county. We included the school properties as well in our evaluation, narrowed it down to 5 sites that would be potentially feasible for mitigation banks, for stream bank and wetland credits. The number one was Fowler Park property, another one was the Wallace Tatum property, and Midway property, which we did a restoration project there. There were a couple others too. Probably, like I say, only a couple sites that might have potential that we didn't evaluate at the time that we've purchased since. Probably highest on the list would be the Jottendale property on Taylor Creek. But we could also look at the Hall Creek property. But our consultant, CHGML, they evaluated the 53 properties, narrowed it down to 5 potentially feasible sites. The presentation was given to the board in a PowerPoint. Part of the information included the cost for a property to be developed for a potential bank, be probably anywhere from $600,000 to $2.5 million, depending on the site and required improvements. And they determined at that time what potentially credits could be derived from a particular property. Of course, they're all estimates. After the presentation in 2009, the board just didn't take any action. There was, you know, in our minds, really no interest. But if there is renewed interest now, we could have them update.
How much would it cost to just do an update?
They come about $4,200 to update the report.
And
update
in that
the presentation.
Update?
They could also, in the update, which they didn't do in 2009, is maybe a cost-benefit
analysis. That's what Tim suggested.
Do some estimated construction costs. Of course, it'll be plus or minus a certain percentage, and then you'll have your construction costs. But it's going to take you, if you decide to pursue it on a project, it'll take you probably a year to get approval, and you'll get your credits over a 7-year period. So, you know, the key would be you'd want to at least be able to recoup your investment. You may be able to generate revenue, you may not. But even if you don't, there's a combined benefit of meeting other requirements that the county has in our Metropolitan North Georgia Water Planning
District.
So
it's not wasted information.
In our NPDES permitting, we have certain mandates to do certain watershed improvements. Well, then this could go toward those as well, just like our restoration projects. But it's just up to the board if you want to update that, and we could, and bring it back.
Because of the uncertainty of whether or not there's a value balance between the construction cost of getting it, what you get in those points, what the value of those points are, is that why you wouldn't give staff recommendation on that settlement? Because you didn't believe they truly had that value they were claiming?
Well, it's, like I say, it's an unknown. You know, it could be assumed to be speculative, which, but then again, they would claim it's probably not.
They didn't even start the process to even get anything done to show anything.
They never started the process from that
to show what value to their claim.
John,
well, let's talk about this. Yes. Not about
John. Is it true that in general, or maybe all the time, you have to own both sides of the stream for it to be considered as something you can reclaim or get? Turn into credits.
That's as I recall that to be the case.
And do you remember the place, I think you said at Midway, that we did restore, how much we spent and how long of a stream we restored, roughly?
Well, that,
20 feet.
That was not a mitigation plan. That was just a stream restoration project.
Restoration.
That was done with a grant, but it helped us meet certain mandates.
What types of things would we have had to do to that site get a minute to make it a
well it didn't
thing.
Qualify
didn't qualify okay
it didn't qualify it was I believe now they look for a mile to a mile and a half of stream length. So there are certain requirements for a bank, and those were things that went into the analysis of the properties to determine which ones would be feasible. And that's why it was, out of all the county properties and all the school properties, it was narrowed down to 5 at that time, out of 53. And those 53 wasn't the total properties. Those were the ones that just had streams on them.
Right. But it's hard for me to believe we have any site that has a mile or a mile and a half of stream bank.
Both sides.
I think it is kind of both sides. And it's not just the stream, it's the tributaries.
Right. Do we have anywhere that we have a mile and a half of running property on a stream?
I don't know.
We had 5 qualified.
We had 5 feasible sites.
Yeah.
Have those rules changed?
I may be incorrect. It was 1,500.
Like
maybe it was 1,500 feet.
We did some looking into this similar on Fowler, and I think
it may be 1,500 feet.
We self-performed some mitigation on Fowler, a part of it. We didn't restore it. If you ask the question, we had to plant trees in our properties. It was just a wetland restoration, and we mitigated instead of stream.
That was, yeah, you mitigated for your own
right.
credits
but,
on
you know,
your
it
own
depends
property.
On what you're trying to do and how much it's going to cost.
But the rules change and all over the years, so things have changed. So your ideal locations would be more like that, but we've not met with the Corps to see, you know, what they would think and how receptive they would be. Just like, for instance, the Fowler Park property, they show a stream length of 9,500 feet. Well, that's 5,280 feet a mile. So that would almost be 2 miles.
Is that both sides? Is it necessary?
That's counting tributaries and all, you see. Mm-hmm.
Total streams.
Total stream.
Tributaries and all.
Well, I think the money is not going to waste, that you can use what we find in the report in other areas. What would it hurt to go ahead and let them update it and us see if we have any value and what the value would be? It's not, you said $4,400?
$4,200 is what they estimate based on the number of hours it would take to update it, provide that information. It's just really a matter of whether the board has an interest in doing a mitigation.
The construction cost.
Because you're going to have to put the construction cost up front, and it could be anywhere, depending on the site, anywhere from $500,000 to $2.5 million.
But it would give us the cost analysis that you would spend this, but it would be worth this in the report, correct?
Have you ever seen them balance to where they actually...
Well, typically they make money, but now in the downturn, the dollars are down, so there's more credits than people are buying, so they're worth
it. What was the reason in 2009? Was it a cost effectiveness? Were we spending more money?
We never got to a point to the only estimates that were done is some construction estimates on the Fowler Park site, and maybe a little on the Midway site since we're doing that restoration project. But we never got to a point where we did a cost to benefit analysis, because there just didn't appear to be any interest. The board took no action, didn't give us any direction in proceeding.
Will the $4,200 cover that cost, the construction cost to benefit in the report, or does that
limit more? It should. I mean, that should be the simplest part of it, because it's going to be just an estimate, and it's going to be probably plus or minus 25 to 50%. But you'll have a future value. It's just, but you're going to have that future need to recoup that value.
We'll have a plug for other communities.
What about 42? Can we get to 42 out of splash green space, or
we've got it in our budget?
Got it
in
the budget.
Yeah, we've got a task order for City of Stone Hill, and we could fund that out of our stormwater budget.
I'll make a motion that we ask the transportation department to do an update of the study for mitigation bank and the cost analysis.
Cost benefit analysis,
and do we need to not exceed $4,200, or
what's the price?
Or
yes.
We should not
budget. Why don't you make it 5,000?
Say 5,000, not to exceed 5,000, or
what'd you put the budget on?
Well, I'm not sure off the top of my head, but our budget's probably more around $300,000. So you don't think you want to not to exceed?
Just don't put an amount on.
I would just say just to complete the work.
Just complete
okay.
the study.
Based on just to complete the study.
And we'll make sure it's reasonable and not over too much.
Have a motion, have a second.
Second.
Have a motion, a second. To update the study for the mitigation feasibility report. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Just don't go to Bahamas and do that study, John. Item 26, to the joint venture for South County Schools.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. I will take this. You would like to look at the letter under tab number 26 in the agenda book. Near the end of last year, I was able to attend a meeting with Jerry Kinsey and Todd Shirley of Forsyth County Schools, school board member Morsi was in attendance also, and we talked about trying to duplicate what we have at Joint Venture Park, which has worked out very, very well. A little background on that, 16 acres that the school system owned, and we went in and developed it, and Park and Rec hit the park, I think, after 4 o'clock in the afternoon, is that right, Jerry? So what we'd like to do, and I think they're in agreement with it, and this letter speaks to that, is that we would do a needs assessment and then a master plan on developing some of their existing fields with lighting and restrooms. And then negotiate with them as far as maintenance. This would be much more cost effective than going out trying to buy more land for rectangular fields. Quite frankly, they probably have some pretty good locations. Parking's already there. Activities sometimes are already there. It's worth a look, I think.
Do you have a list of those schools which you will look at for the needs assessment?
No. The needs assessment would compile that list pretty much on the needs of where they're on where
population
where the population is and where we have a lack of rectangular fields. I think we're in agreement with this.
The money to develop this would come out of our splash funds. Is that
sure?
Where would that come out?
I think it is. Is it design fee or?
Well, if you're gonna, if you said light, put restrooms. Is that how we do it?
Well, first of all, for the needs assessment.
Fields?
Yes.
I think in our master plan it says that, you know, where the needs are, but we also have in our master plan that we want to, you know, continue building parks, go some to the north end. Mm-hmm. But as anybody knows, the south end does have the most schools, most kids, blah, 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 and they got more middle schools, more high schools in that area. But if you're going to light, I mean, that's what you stated, light and put restrooms in. We did, we tried this about, in 2008, I got a letter here, we went to Liberty Middle School, which we can't put for Liberty. But also, I think the two best schools just from staffing would be South Middle and also Vickery. They have the two best ball fields, two locations where they got more parking, don't have problems. I think Tiny Grove has got a problem, the field sets right next to a roadway. There's no room for spectators there. But we have done. We never talked to principals. I don't know if there's going to be agreement between the school board and the board of commissioners, because every principal runs their schools. And they got the right to say, if you can come in, you can't come in. I mean, that's the way I've been.
It's certainly, Jerry, I guess you'd agree that the one time there was a little bit of a disagreement of what, how much maintenance we would do to what our benefit would be of how much time we could use of those fields for what we were putting into the fields, and it didn't work out. And before spending money, I would like to know that we have a reasonable agreement that works for all parties.
Right.
But I don't really need a needs assessment.
I do think you want a needs assessment because they want to make sure that they have some equality or parity with their different schools in different parts of the county.
What's the needs assessment? How much do you think it's going to cost for the needs assessment? Jerry?
He says he already has one.
Well, I got the master contract.
He's got the master plan in his opinion, their opinion.
We didn't address any school properties.
But you said just board and staff.
But wouldn't it address the areas in which the needs were, and then you find the school that's centrally located in that area, and if they're willing to work with you?
Well, every school I've ever been involved with, at middle school and high school, their fields are used and booked from the time they get out of school until 8 or 9 o'clock
at
night.
Until dark. So if we put lights on them.
But your younger kids will have no benefit because they can't wait to practice till 8:30 at night.
Or even 9.
Or 9
they're there at 10, 11 when they get in the bed.
I mean, it would only be to benefit your oldest kids, and then you get your parents, I know from Park and Rec Board, that go 8 over practicing at 9 o'clock at night.
Oh, yeah. Kids are tired of school.
Let's let Jerry and staff look at it. Just do a quick assessment about everything.
He says it's got. They've got.
We wanted to like Liberty, and we had the money to do it because there was only one field that Jerry picked, one field. That there were three fields to be done, and he tried to space them out throughout the county. And they got George Butler involved. Ascot Subdivision just went crazy about it, and so it was killed because of that.
And obviously you don't want to spend a need assessment and then find out you're not going to do it anyway.
Well, his staff is going to do it. Jerry said his staff and our staff can do it.
Well, that's reasonable.
Without getting professionals involved.
I just want to read from his letter. This study would identify the need for potential improvement of and long-term use of some Forsyth County school sports fields, including the addition of turf, lights, and restrooms to specific school practice fields.
Well, can we just do that jury bring back?
Well, we can.
Yeah, let Jerry. They've got something going. These guys.
But I don't want him out doing that without the board being on board.
Fair enough.
You said then turf, lights, and restrooms. Is that what we're looking at?
Yep.
Because turf's high dollar stuff, and I hate to put it on the school field.
And then you get into.
That's right. But it's worked out. But it has worked out well at joint venture. That field.
We have a turf field.
No, we don't have a turf field, but we.
But it worked well because it's a park for the school.
Yeah, they use it during the day.
And you get it every day at 4:00.
Jerry can go down and talk to principals or send talk to the boards and bring back what interest this young.
They've been living and breathing this for years.
And then the next question is where will the money come from if you were even able to do it? Because I'm hanging on to my bond money that goes to the North Parks. I mean, that was.
Well, we can't use that without these bills? Are you sure?
No, we'll find them.
We don't have to put it in the door because that'll just alleviate the pressure on the side.
But I'm hoping that we'll get some more rectangle fields in the near future.
I'm hoping we will too.
But there's
the
a great
way,
need.
The cheapest way to go is using some of their existing practice fields.
If you can get them.
If you can get them.
I mean, the problem has been in the past is that the coaches feel ownership, mm-hmm. and then the second to ownership are the principals. And it's just very difficult.
Each
one is a case by case.
It is, and some are more willing, and some are much more willing
some
than others.
Some are.
And you don't want to spend $500,000 upgrading the field and network for that principal. Make sure they get a different principal, and they own this $500,000.
You're right. Well, we didn't do that at joint venture. We had a long term agreement, and after 4:00. We get it. I don't know how many times they've changed principles,
nice.
But I would suspect they have.
That's
but
reasonable.
We still have that agreement in place.
Even if it's 5:00, you
and if we turf that field, we get more use of it. Mm-hmm. That may be one we target right away.
Well, but yeah, as Jenny said, most high school coaches aren't going to get that field up.
No,
they
banned it.
No,
we're talking mostly
middle schools. Yeah.
We've got a proposed project to bring in Dave Street. I mean, to turf that. It's already got parking, it's already got lighting, and you can turf it.
I met with Bennett Park last night, and they have 5 football teams practicing at the same time.
Oh yeah, they're
they have no, exactly. They are such a dire need for rectangle fields.
That's right.
A lot worse.
So, let's be proactive. But if he did, if he was out doing this without the board's knowledge,
right.
How would you feel about that?
Oh yeah, I think it doesn't hurt anything. And Jerry and them definitely have the knowledge and the information at hand to be able to do it.
We'll talk to the principal, see how much time they allow. When can we come in?
When
can we leave? How much use we get out of it?
If
we build
motion,
the restrooms, who may
yes.
take them?
No, and may I add, Jerry, while you're doing that, if there's any land in the area, because if you're putting turf fields in that stuff, a lot of money, and lights is a lot of money. So see what happens if there's anything out there that may work for us to have owned and share with the schools the other way. Either way.
Or we buy more land and build.
Either way, and if they need to share with us, either way. Or maybe it's adjoining their schools where we could do a joint venture that way.
North,
they
we took care of
land
and the
man.
Or we could, I like that too. If they have extra land outside of their field already existing.
I don't think, we did that a long time ago too. We did Liberty and Chester, we actually had extra land. Besides school, we can develop. The only one we came up with was
Chester T has 15 acres, but they've got septic fields underneath it.
That's
not good.
And the fences.
Okay.
We ran sewer to Dave's Creek to make that work.
Who's got it? Make motion.
I'll make a motion that we direct Jerry Kinsey and his staff to come back with a list of recommendations. Possible joint ventures with the Forsyth County Schools.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve the discussion for the staff to come back with some recommendations. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Carries 5-0. Item 27, Ram Properties, Rain Properties.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, you have in your agenda packet a document called a release of rights under agreement for reserve sewer capacity. It is appropriate that we were discussing sewer refunds previously. This is a sewer refund. Tim is here to speak to the mechanics of the actual refund itself. I believe the board has already approved this before. So you have already approved the sewer refund before. What messed it up, though, was the state of the entity that we were trying to give the refund to. I believe the actual refund was going to Rain Properties LLC. That was the entity, I think, that entered into the original sewer reservation agreement. However, because of a host of things, not the least of which is the principal of Rain Properties, Inc., William Brinson, is he deceased? Is that correct? Yeah, we then had to get, of course, the executrix involved. We wanted to make sure that every potential party that might have a claim on these funds was signing off on the receipt of sewer refunds. So the amount is $54,150. We now have all parties agreeing that they are in receipt of that fund, so they will then distribute it however they see fit. We will see it, of course. But I would like, just for purposes of sort of sewing this up, for the board to ratify this release of sewer refund funds to the estate of William A. Brinson individually, DBA Rain Majors Road LLC, and then also Rain Properties LLC.
Did any restocking fee apply to this?
There was.
Did they agree to pay for it? Is that a motion from the board? We've already approved it, you said, one time.
You have.
It's just different.
It's just because of the estate being involved, it took a while for the attorneys to get all the legal work.
That motion.
And let me just say, just to make it a little easier, I know there was a lot to bite off there. Basically, it would be a refund to two parties, Rain Properties LLC and the estate of William Brinson individually doing business as Rain at Majors Road LLC and as the member manager of Rain at Majors Road LLC.
So moved.
Time sensitive.
We have a motion and a second for a sewer refund request. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All in opposed? Motion carries. Can we do this now, Ben?
We can.
Yeah.
We can do it in 2 minutes.
It's going to be more than that. We need to take a little break. Okay. Item 28. Yes. Sidewalk connectivity between Brookwood Elementary and Candy Creek, sir.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. This project makes a lot of sense. If you'll notice on the map, you see Candy Road. We just opened the park last summer. If you follow the red line down halfway down to the right-hand side, you'll see Brookwood Elementary. And then on past that, you'll see some 500 homes. So what we have is a lot of foot traffic going to the school and trying to go to the park. Candy Road, if you look at the map up here, you can see the red line. Is a SLOS 7 cruise project. Voted on the last SLOS. I'm not proposing that we do that whole project now. All I'm proposing is that we take it to the entrance of the park. The project calls for it, which is approved, calls for it to go to Alpharetta, Old Alpharetta Road, and up Old Alpharetta Road.
Are you suggesting from the elementary school to the park?
You see the elementary school?
Yes.
All right, I'm suggesting from the elementary school to the park, but I'm also suggesting about the whole stretch of Brookwood Road is 0.72 miles, so I would call that about a quarter of a mile.
There's a traffic light right here, did you say?
Yeah, we just installed a new traffic light, did an intersection improvement there. So that's the main in and out. There's a right in, right out on the left-hand side. That's the main in and out for those 500 homes. So they're coming out of there and walking up Brookwood Road to try to get to either a school or B, the park, or both.
Now you said this was in SLOS 7 funds or SLOS 6?
Kenny Road, that section of it is approved in SLOS 7.
Okay, but you want to put the sidewalk this, in now?
Yeah, but this here.
How does that work for the
where's the money come from?
Yeah, and then how do you reimburse it?
This Brookwood qualifies as a SLOS 6 project under transportation safety.
What category?
Well, if we advance fund this project and the board agrees to move forward with it and It would be used, we'd use Forsyth funds, and it would be traffic safety improvements funds, which you can build sidewalk projects.
For the entire sidewalk, we can call it Canyon.
For the entire sidewalk. Any projects that we try to advance funding with in Forsyth. It'll just free up money in Forsyth 7. That's the way I look at it. I don't know that you have to reimburse on the Davis.
They're in both, right?
You know, they're in both. They could be funded in both. And if we happen to have, you know, advance fund a Forsyth 7 project against Forsyth 6 funds, then that's going to just free up money there for other projects.
Well, a couple things. One is, why does it have to go to the entrance to the park? Why can't it go, if there is one, to the first path of the park? Because now you're in the park and you can walk through the park to the entrance.
I don't think there's any connectivity there, which has a trail on it.
It's a very steep trail, goes across the road for a mile. Very steep.
You'd have to walk all the way around the backside of the park to get to the main part of the park.
It's about a mile trail through the...
Most people are going to the main entrance of the park. Where the restrooms are.
That's one thing. The next thing is, aren't we just deathly afraid that this is going to be impervious surface?
Not one bit.
It's
a county
right away,
most of it.
I know, but. Well, it would normally be a sidewalk. Complaints about impervious surface on the park.
Over a sidewalk?
No, it wasn't. He was misunderstanding. It was
impervious.
He was called impervious. It's just going to be a walking trail. So,
he was incorrect.
This will be impervious.
Right next to our right-of-way.
I'm just trying to be sensitive to the needs that I hear down there, which is impervious surface.
Well, it's also approved, voter approved, it's law 7.
Why don't we bring this back and see who else has emergency sidewalks?
Yeah, I got a bunch of sidewalks that now there's free money available. I'd like to, you know, pay most of District 5.
I don't know if there's free money available.
I don't know if it's free money, but I think it's fair to each one of us look at each one of our communities to see where we believe there's emergency traffic.
And you know what? You should. But this community is different because we've opened a park and they have opened a school.
I've got three schools right next to my park.
Okay.
Three schools.
I'm not opposed to any sort of connectivity with that, but I'm telling you that this is more densely populated than up there.
My concern is not whether you support it. My concern is if there's any money after your project.
This is also voter approved. Half of it is Canyon Creek's voter approved.
I don't think any of us have anything this dense sitting next to a park right now. I'd love to, but I don't.
Well, I'm not sure the issue is necessary, you know. Well, she never gets anything because she's the least sensitive.
No, who says she doesn't get anything?
I'm just saying it, but Brian, it's voter approved, and it's a safety issue.
It's voter approved for SPLOS 7.
So?
We're not at SPLOS 7. If it comes out of SPLOS 6 money now, there's something in SPLOS 6 that doesn't get done now.
You can pay it back if you have to. That's SPLOS 7.
I'm just telling you, that's the way it works.
Well, let me tell you where we are with SPLOS 6. With SPLOS 6, we're finishing things up. We have four more reclamation projects left, and we know about what they're going to cost. We've got two intersection projects. We've estimated them, and they're about ready to go to bid. We'll build them this year. We've got our resurfacing for this year. We've got a bridge that we're going to do with traffic safety improvement money on Doc Brown Road across that now creek. We're going to do it this year. We've got a culvert project identified and ready to go that we're going to bid out for this summer down on Nichols Road. We're getting to a point to where we're nearing the end of SPLOS 6 and are coming close to fulfilling our obligations on our priority A projects.
But what about priority B?
Well, you know, we're going to have to get legal to look at that and see, you know, what we have to do and what we don't have to do, and the board will have to make a decision on that. I think what Ken's probably going to tell you is we don't have to do anything in B, and as long as we fulfill our obligations in A.
This qualifies as traffic safety.
I'll have to look at the resolution, but I think that's the way it was worded, that B was almost purely discretionary.
It was.
From the board's perspective.
I can tell you that I had a conversation with Mr. Kennard about a month ago, and we have at least two, if not three, roads in our county that the bicyclist groups that consist of hundreds upon hundreds of members use at hundreds upon hundreds at a time. and they're on such narrow roads that they are causing traffic with the new law to have a 3-foot gap between them and the bicycles, and they are allowed to cross a double yellow line under state law now with that 3-foot gap, and that you find vehicles almost having head-on collisions, I find that more of an emergency safety issue than the sidewalk, but yet Mr. Kennard said there wasn't funds for that, so I don't understand how there is for a sidewalk.
That's a lot more than $300,000.
Yeah. Well, whatever it is, I don't know about that either.
He's got 1 minute left before we have to.
Yeah, we got him.
Great. I'm going to make a motion on time sensitive that we approve this project as presented, provided to the clerk.
I'm going to look for your support or something like that.
You know where to find
me. I'll second it. And I want, though, to ask that...
You have a second time sensitive.
Second time sensitive, but I want to ask that you look at Hall Creek Park and give a cost estimate and see if you have money to do, because I know all about that park, and it definitely needs a connectivity with the schools and those subdivisions.
I think we're going to have those funds. What I can't tell you is how much funds, and Dave can't tell you right now either. I think we're probably, hopefully, going to have $10 million. It could be... 20 million, I guess.
Okay.
But
John, Mr. Keith, we need to take a vote. We need to take a vote on this. Yeah, we have a motion and a second. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
Aye.
4-1. Just a vote. Time sensitive. Does council have a need for executive session?
There is. There is an agenda for executive.
Is there a motion to recess the work session and go into executive session for discussion of litigation, land acquisition, and personnel?
So move.
Second.
Yes. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
No. That's why I'm saying we'll probably have.
Just take a 10-minute break. 5:10.
All year, you just recreate and get the whole thing put together for recognition. We're about ready.
We're
that. Yeah, because you've got to look at the public safety area and what was the savings we had in other areas too. So.
That's why I need a number. I can do a schedule and regular.
He's taking $10 million.
That's all I need.